You are. Connor, take these cable ties. We don't need them all. Don't be silly, man. Connor's brain doesn't work at this time of the morning, everybody. That's Connor, everybody. Best-looking man in the Wild Earth team. There he goes.
He's a little bit shy.
He's a little bit shy. There's Taylor. And you can also see her roof. We've also got a roof on account of the precipitation, haven't we, Brian?
Yes,
heavy precipitation this morning. And also behind the bush there, hiding behind the bush, you can see Gendre, a.k.a. Hoppy Virus Brain.
Love you, James.
Are you feeling better today, Gendre? He can't really speak at the moment. His brain is addled with some sort of disease that entered his body through his sinuses. And the hospital vehicle, both of them, not in a great way, everybody. So don't get too close to them. Otherwise, you might get infected. Not so, Brian?
Yes, very true.
Brian is now putting the rain cover on, as well as the roof that we have upon our heads.
There's too much water out here today.
There's a lot of water, everybody. The song Raindrops Are Falling on My Head comes to mind. Singing in the rain.
My Fair Lady.
Yes, that one also.
Yes.
Welcome to the Jungle by Guns N' Roses, that sort of thing.
Highway to Hell by Meatloaf.
Bat Out of Hell by Meatloaf. Yes, I think that was AC/DC with Highway to Hell. Yes. Yes, look, if it was in the afternoon and our voices were warmed up, we might even sing that song. I'm just watching Hoppy Virus Brain walking back into the workshop. He now thinks he's a mechanic. It's very difficult to keep him going. Yes. I'm having a conversation now with Taylor. She's asking me something. Yes. Yes. Well, Karula was on a kill with her two cubs on Shibam Road. So, look, I'm not going to tell you what to do, but yeah, you'd rather look for ducks.
Okay.
Right, Brian, are we ready?
I think so.
Okay, good. Right. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Taylor.
Vive la France.
Vive to the French.
We don't know why, but that's what we say anyway. Am I going to hit
an... You say that.
I say that. I'm not French. I don't know why I say it. Okay. Now, this roof is very effective, everybody, if you're driving in a northwesterly direction. We are now driving in a southeasterly direction, which means the rain cover is all but utterly ineffective. How's your back roof there, Brian?
Wonderful.
Yes.
The water comes in from every angle.
Good.
It's wonderful.
Except the back.
Sometimes the back.
Yes. Why do we have sideways rain when we have a roof? Gosh, that is a very unpleasant driving in this direction. Ugh. Some Nyala over there, which I'm not going to stop for. Ooh, I think when we do stop for anything, we'll be turning to the northwest to avoid the driving rain coming out of the southeast. Ooh. 1 minute left of the pre-show, everybody.
1 minute.
1 minute. That's why I'm just doing a very gentle version of it. See? I'm on the highway to hell. Highway to hell. Bing, bing. Highway to hell. Beep, 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 beep. Highway to hell. Beep, 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 beep. Highway to hell.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to what can only be described as a deeply unpleasant weather situation here in the western fringes of the Kruger National Park. Good morning, Brian.
Good morning, Jim.
Yes, there is Brian, everybody. He is just going to untangle himself from the roof, from the rain cover, and there is his thumb.
Oh, you can't really see it.
No, you can't, because there is a driving mist blowing into the rain. And this is Safari Live, sorry. I was supposed to make a very short introduction. I, of course, forgot to do that, and so that is why you got a long, waffly introduction from me, and here we are. Now, we are going to go along and see, rather sadly, if we can find the lion cub who had the broken back yesterday. I'm not sure if it made it through the night, so I do warn you. We may or may not be able to get in there. I'm not sure. We'll try and see what we can see. In the meantime, the good news is Taylor is back out on dry. We both have rain covers and rain roofs on, which means that even though it will probably rain for much of the morning, we should be able to maintain the drive, which will be the first time in forever that we've managed to do that in rain. So that's very good. The original design, of course, should probably be credited to Mr. Scott Dyson, that great engineer and designer of things. He came up with the sort of Flintstone version of what we have now. Connor perfected it, and with any luck, we'll be able to maintain the drive for the duration of the morning. Now, you must talk to us, please. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. Share us your thoughts and questions and comments. I will just say, though, that as we go and try and make our way into this place where the lion cub was, just bear in mind that I'm happy to have discussions about human interference in the wild and that sort of thing, but please understand that we as Wild Earth support the Sabi Sand policy of non-interference when it comes to this sort of thing. And we also are powerless to do anything about it. We're here as tenants, guests on the land, and so please just understand that in the context of any discussions that you would like to have about the lion cub and any kind of human interference, which I think the topic is a very interesting one, but we A, support the Sabi Sand policy, and B, we are powerless to do anything regardless. There's a giraffe, Brian. It's our first animal of the day.
Hooray!
Yes. Of course, we will have to be virtually underneath it to see it on account of the fact that it is hiding in a cloud which is now sitting upon us. Now, I'm just going to look for some tracks here. That's interesting. Human tracks on the ground. I think that is from the very speedy walking that Stefan and David engaged in yesterday evening. Let's have a quick look at this giraffe, and then we'll try and make our way down to where that cub was. The difficulty is, of course, that this roof is going to make it quite hard for us to get in there. The roof has to be on, otherwise Brian's camera will get wet. So will Brian, of course. And Brian is made of sugar, and we don't want him to melt, do we, Brian?
No.
So sweet, so sugary. That is our first animal. Now, I need to park like that, I think, so that you don't get the pole in the way. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yes. There we are. All right, let's just have a bit of a listen, a calm down. It's been a very rapid start to the morning, what with our physical exercise involved in putting this cover on, trying to find the bolts that were lost yesterday. And the giraffe is eating a Sisyphus or buffalo thorn, surrounded by the sounds of rattling cisticola, long-billed crombrick, crested Franklin. Right, let's go from this wet, very tall, Brian-like animal across to Taylor McCurdy and a, well, scruffy and wet, colourful bird.
Good morning, and well, I suppose the rain needs no introduction today. As you can see, this roller is doing a fine job of showing us how miserable everything is looking this morning. Isn't this quite lovely? Now, it's going to be interesting as we test these roofs out in the real rain, but my name is Taylor, and on camera with me this morning, I've just pulled my earpiece out, is Jandre. Sorry, let me plug that back in. Oh, that's very cheeky of you popping out so early in the morning. But shame, this poor little bird. And I wonder, it hasn't really chosen the best spot to sit. If I was a bird, I probably would have chosen a tree with a fair amount of leaves on it, because I don't think there's going to be too much time actually throughout the day to really dry your feathers. And obviously we know the feathers need to be nice and dry to fly to the best of their ability. Well, and when they're wet, I suppose they become a little bit more on the clumsy side. Are you waiting for the insects, for all the alates to come out? Perhaps Mr. Roller or Mrs. Roller? No response. Well, our plan this morning, though, is to head on towards Shibum Road to go and have a look and see if perhaps Karula is still around. So I think let's move on from the roller. We're here on Philemon's Cutline, so we're not far away from Shibum's Road. And I'm sure we will see the vehicle tracks as to where Karula was. Now, it's good to be back in the vehicle. It feels like it's been forever since I was last driving. Just make sure my earpiece doesn't come out again. Right. Jandre, you said you haven't seen a leopard in a while. So Jandre is ecstatic and hoping to see Karula and to see if her cubs are well. I can't imagine those cats, though, will be looking too pleasant this morning. We've had a substantial amount of rain, but luckily it hasn't been a huge downpour all at once. It's just come through quite nicely, a nice slow soaking rain. You're going to see Jandre is going to continuously wipe the camera lens. And that's because as we drive, all the rain still comes in the vehicle. It's much better when we stop. Right, let's see who we're going to get around the next corner. Now, we're quite happy if it does rain that it rains like it is at the moment. So there were some impala footprints that looked like cat tracks, but they weren't. It wasn't a cat track. And the reason why, and I've spoken about it before, is because when we get these sort of flash showers of rain, it really does destroy the not just the roads, but it removes all the topsoil off of all the anywhere really, and creates a lot of erosion. And we try and put implements to try and stop things like that. So from the gabions and the crossings, which we make out of rocks, and we cover them with mesh, we put them up against the walls to try and help with a bit of support. And then of course we've got these big bolsters on the road with the mitre drains going off to the side to try and so that the rain doesn't of course sit on the road. But only so much can be done. Now, I don't know where Karula was, so we'll have to just take this road very slowly, and we'll see if we can see her or any footprints. And remember, we are on a live safari, so I'd love to hear from you. Or perhaps you could help me. Maybe you could tell me what Karula killed, because I can't seem to remember what Brent or anybody said what she did take down. But it'd be nice to know, because I suspect that it's going to be eaten quite a bit, whatever it was. Let me quickly... No, wrong radio. Let me grab this one. Morning. I'm just making my way to try relocate on Karula and her cubs. Copy. There you go. Just letting Rex know what's happening. Now, I hope we haven't driven past her yet. Well, we'll see. Now, Shibum Road is actually quite long. It's not the shortest of roads. But remember when we found Karula, when we were called into the sighting 2 mornings ago, 2 mornings ago, Remember, we were right here. So I wonder, maybe she went off, we saw her disappearing. And perhaps when she was coming back, maybe she'd given up. Maybe she then spotted something, whatever it may have been that she took down. Will be quite interesting. I do apologize because of all the moisture and the rain that we're getting on top of us. My earpiece is sliding around and doesn't quite want to stay in my ear this morning. Okay, I can see lots of vehicle tracks here. Let me have a look. Every time I turn, my earpiece comes out. That's nice. So I remember, Chandra, when we saw them the other day, she left the cubs in this thicket, but she's obviously moved from here. You probably remember this area, all those thick bushes. Now, I'm going to have to do a bit of inspecting up and down here, as I'm not sure where the kill was, and some of the tire tracks have been washed away in the rains that we have had. But Steph is ready to say good morning from the tent.
Yes, I'm actually ready to say good morning. Finally, they have confined me to the tent today. So unfortunately, you got my company today in James's cell, as we like to call it jokingly around the breakfast table. But yes, we're coming to you from the tent today. Apparently, we've got some muffled audio issues. Let me just get rid of this. I'm totally out of my element here, as you probably can see, which is okay. We'll get ourselves going here. Don't worry. How does that sound? All better? Maybe, maybe not. All right, a little bit better. We'll get the aesthetics right in a little bit. But anyway, I'm hoping to play around here today and regale you with some of my stories from the last week and the last couple of years, and also to invite you to ask me some questions, things that you may or may not get around to while you're watching the show under normal conditions, or under sunny conditions, I should say. And yeah, it's going to be a fun couple of hours with us telling and sharing these little things. I must say, right off the cuff, the most exciting thing to happen this week has been the finding of the beehive at the end of the Honey Guides Trail. And I can see David above me shaking his head vigorously as he agrees that that was probably for us the sighting of the week. And of course, the saddest sighting of the week being that little lion cub, whose fate I hope that we figure out relatively soon, and can share that with you as well. What else has been going on? The rain has arrived. We've had a lot of cloudy days, consecutive cloudy days, culminating in what could be rain, what could be called rain, although isn't quite what we expect out here, is this mist rain that wets everything but doesn't quite do much else, I don't think. I was kicking around the sand in the staff village today, and the water goes down about this much, and then it's dry sand underneath. So wow, it looks all wet and shiny outside. It definitely isn't. It isn't what we need just yet. We're going to need a lot more rain to break this drought, I think. And as welcome as what this is, I hope that it lasts a long time, or a longer time at least. Anyway, we've got rain predicted here for the next couple of days. I think until Saturday or Sunday, I think, is when I saw the weather prediction clearing us up for some partly cloudy things, and then back into summer sun again. So it looks like we're in for another couple of days of rain and blustery conditions, which is a good thing, at least anyway. All right, I think what we've got now is we've got James, who has arrived at the sighting in the Mulwati and is ready to show you what happened last night.
Right, everybody, for those of you who do not wish to be distressed today, I would suggest that you go and make yourself a cup of coffee or pour yourself a drink. We have found the cub. It is still alive. So we're going to have a quick look at it, and then we're going to leave. There is the hapless little fellow. And breathing now, very labored. And I don't think it's long for this world. It's just quite a sort of interesting testimony, I think, to the lack of scavengers in this area, that it's still alive and that nothing has come through here. And the hyenas normally would have passed through this area probably three or four times a night, and nothing has come past here, obviously. And interestingly also, of course, one of the things that often happens is that a lion pride will eat one of the cubs that dies. And in this case, they've just kind of left it. And this is the harshness of lion society. It's the harshness of the wilderness, and it's the harshness of the world, I suppose. You take with the good with the bad. It's very distressing, and I understand that many of you are feeling very distressed by this. I certainly am, so is Brian. And we're just going to leave this little fellow to pass on eventually. I wish he would do it quickly, but of course it's not really up to him. So from the sort of extinguishing of a life, we're going to reverse, or in fact I'm just going to ask Brian to turn around if you can, up there in a tree, new life. And there's a leopard orchid there that's just flowered. There we are. So, great contrast in emotion. We've got the beauty of the Christmas flower, I like to call it. Normally they sort of flower around Christmas time. Beautiful leopard orchid, lovely smell. And then the very great sadness, of course, of this little cub who's not long for this world. All right, that's going to be it, everybody. I don't want to be here for another second, so we're going to leave. And while we do that, let's head across to Taylor and get an update from her.
We are looking for the leopards. I cannot see the leopards though, and now this is always fun because we've got a roof attached to us, and I'm very much used to driving with a roof, as when I was guiding down in the south on these cold, miserable days, and also when it was, or any transfers that we did during, outside of game drives, we didn't do game drives with the roof, we had to use them. And well, sometimes when I was taking my guests back and forth to the airports and all those types of things, we used to see things along the way. So off-road I would go with the roof very carefully. Of course, you don't want to rip the top. But and luckily for us, this is a nice open area. But it doesn't look like Karula is here anymore. I'm just triple checking all the marula trees. And we will just triple check some more. We'll do another loop. But I can't see her. And Rexon has just said to me that he had some impala alarm calling a wee distance away from us. So possibly she's maybe moved on. Like I said, I'm not sure what she did catch and exactly where it was. But whatever it was, it's not here anymore. Now, I haven't picked up any tracks either, which is quite interesting. It would obviously be quite difficult though with all the rain that we've had. I'm just triple checking along here. No, it doesn't look like anything. Let's just do another little loop and a lap. It's very easy to miss things out in the bush, especially when it's a dull day and there's, well, quite a bit of rain and clouds around. Always makes it a little bit more tricky. But they wouldn't have had to have gone too far for water, because we have a mud wallow here that would have easily provided some moisture for them to drink. So that would have been quite close by. But the road that we're on is quite clayey, so it's not nice and soft and sand that if she does walk you would see those footprints. It seems as though the ground is quite hard. Right. So if she's not here, we'll probably go across and help Rexon with the attempt of looking for Karula and trying to follow up. Hang on, wait. No, here's someone else as well having a look. Let's stop for a quick chat. And it seems as they knew exactly, obviously, where the leopard was. But they haven't stopped either, so that's not good news for us. Yeah. There's Aubrey. Hi, Aubrey. Okay, so Aubrey's going to check Gari Main. Maybe what we should do, we'll let him go because he's got a tracker in front. So it'll be much easier if Aubrey jumps in front of us because his trackers, that's his job. He's trained really well to pick up on the footprints. Hello, hello. Hello. Are you going to check all the way west or are you going to go east? I'll go up then if you want to go down. There we go. We'll split it like that. There we go. Work as a team, which often is the best way to try and find animals. I do want to show you. Look at this. I'm going to just park the vehicle. Look at the, can you, is that a better angle? Yes, that's all right. Look at the mushrooms that have now popped up overnight. Isn't that wonderful? Now, you're probably wondering, can you eat something like that? I'm not sure. And this is probably one of the most difficult things to do in the world, is become a mushroom or a fungi expert and try and be able to identify the mushrooms and the things that you can eat. Now, I wouldn't take a gamble, especially if you're out here, as well, you probably get quite sick if you ate one that you weren't supposed to and potentially die. So we'll leave those alone and we'll see if any of the animals eat them. And well, then we'll take it from there. Let's quickly turn around. But I think what we're going to do now is we're going to quickly go and check west up on Gowrie Main. Let's go to James and see if he's had any luck searching for what he was looking for.
Right, we've left that area. We're now going to see if we can find the rest of the pride. We'll pop up to where they were yesterday. And I'm just listening to the game drive radio here, and it sounds like Karula has gone and done a dirty on us and headed off to the south. Anyway, that is the way it goes. And of course, remember, we have had such a boom time of late, but everywhere in the Sabi Sand has had good rain now over the last week or so. So I'm sure you would have noticed how the number of elephants that we've been seeing has slowly started to dwindle. Did you see any elephants yesterday, Brian?
I didn't, no.
No. Well, we did, actually. We saw them in the morning. We weren't on in the morning, were we?
No.
Anyway, there weren't many elephants around yesterday. And certainly I don't know if they're going to be any today. There weren't any yesterday afternoon during our rehearsal. So they've all moved off. I think you'll find we've had 4 or 5 herds of wildebeest around here. I think they've probably headed off as well, some of them. Hello, Jessica.
You're
of that lion's injury and how I know a male lion did it. I don't know a male lion did it. I just think it's highly likely. Having watched it very briefly yesterday and watching it trying to sit up, it looks to me like its thoracic or lumbar spine has been snapped, which means that anything below that point is not going to function. So its back end wasn't working at all. And I just don't... The last time I saw the whole pride, they were all in exactly that area. One of the males was being fairly nasty and Fumu was being fairly aggressive about things. And I just wonder if that cub didn't get in his way and he would... I mean, it really wouldn't have taken much of a swat on the backside to break the back. And I suspect that's what happened. There's no perforation of the skin, which tells me it probably wasn't another predator. It wasn't a buffalo. If it had been something like a buffalo will kill a cub, wouldn't leave it like that, though. A buffalo would horn it, and you would definitely see some kind of perforation of the skin. At the moment, we can't see anything except the fact that the back is very clearly broken. So, you know, I think that's what's most likely happened. Remember, you know, if you found a leopard cub like that, it'd be a lot more difficult to decide what had happened, because they don't live in a pride. They don't live in, basically, in danger pretty much all the time, which is how a lion cub does live, especially if there's an estrus female around, and there are 2 estrus females in the pride, Amber Eyes and the youngster. So... I don't know. I think that's the best guess we can give, is that it was a male lion. I don't believe it to have been any kind of prey species. Maggie, in Western Australia, we were wondering if it wouldn't be possible for one of the guides or the Sabi San to euthanize the cub. Yes, it would be. Would it help? It might put the cub out of its suffering, but then we are interfering, aren't we? I personally don't think it would be a bad idea. I'm not convinced that it's the best idea. You just never know with these things. I mean, maybe... I mean, this is about a 1% chance. Maybe the back isn't broken. Maybe it's just in a severe spasm and the cub is unable to stand, and that will rectify itself over the course of 48 hours. And if the cub doesn't get eaten by something in that time, then maybe it will stand up and move again. I don't know. I think it's highly unlikely. In fact, I would say it's probably about 98% unlikely. But who knows? And, I mean, certainly, remember, I'm constantly taken back to the incident where we had one of those cubs at the buffalo kill just off Hyena Road at the end of July, beginning of August. And guides from all over the place, including Wild Earth, were saying, well, that cub's going to die. Its pelvis is broken, its back's broken, its femur's broken, its ankle's broken, its knee's broken. Very clearly, it's going to die shortly. Wail, doom, gnashing of teeth. 2 days later, it was absolutely fine. We don't know, you see. And, I mean, we had these exact same discussions when that thing happened. Discussions of, shouldn't we take it out? Shouldn't we fix it? Shouldn't we euthanize it? Why should we want it to suffer? And, well, I think it's still with the pride now, unless that's the very unlucky one there. But I don't think it is. We just don't know what's going on, you know. We haven't examined it. We don't know if the back's broken. I'm 90% sure it is, but... yeah, you know, I think it's best just to let things go. I said to Brian as we left there, I said, wouldn't it just be easier to walk over there and quickly end it? And Brian said, no, not a good idea. Now, I love this question. I think it's a wonderful one from Kristen in North Carolina, because, of course, we could talk about it for years and years. And if I can recommend to you a book to read about such a thing, you can read a book that Louise Pavide lent to me called The Bonobo and the Atheist, or The Atheist and the Bonobo. I'm not sure which one, which order it goes, where he discusses, amongst other things, the sort of origins of religion, but he also discusses emotions in animals. And Kristen, of course, as I've said to you before, it was extremely unfashionable for many years to ascribe any kind of anthropomorphic or human emotion to an animal, because it was felt that that was ridiculous, that only humans felt emotions. Obviously, that's what separated us from all the other species in the world. Now, as I've said to many of you before, any of you who own a cat or a dog, and I know that many of you do, know that that is just patently untrue. Your dogs and your cats absolutely show emotion. You can tell when they show emotion. You can tell when they're sad, when they're depressed, when they're happy. And so it's the extent of that emotion that is actually the question, the interesting discussion that we should be having about these sorts of things. Now, do I think that the pride is feeling an emotion? I don't know. Obviously, I don't know. But, Kristen, I will say that having watched the lioness yesterday morning looking for the cub, calling it, was she feeling a sense of sadness, or was she just kind of trying to make the cub come and join the rest of the pride? I don't know. But I know that she'd been doing that for most of the night, because the day before that she had been doing it. So it's quite possible that there is an element of emotion. And I mean, if you want to be a cold-hearted biologist about it, you must ascribe some sort of evolutionary advantage to emotion. There's the rest of the pride there. That's a bit of luck. Oh, there's certainly two of them. I think it might just be the male and the female. No, there are a few more there. I'll just get into a position here. There we go. While we look at the male lion, then we'll just kind of get a handle on what's going on here, find out where the rest of them are. Kristen, you could say, well, of course, the purpose, the evolutionary purpose of an emotion would be to attach to a youngster so that you look after it, so that it then obviously furthers your genes, because the more emotionally attached to it you are, the more likely you are to put an effort into raising it and protecting it, and therefore the more likely that cub is to further the genes that you've given it. There's Mfumo with the hole in his face. And so, you know, you might say that it's not necessarily an emotion in the same... well, you might say that human beings feel emotion for the same reason. So I think animals feel emotion, yes. Do I think the rest of the pride feels emotion? I think probably less so than the mother. Do I think that the males feel any emotion but for the lost cub? No, I don't. I don't think that they register it, to be honest. I think he certainly seems to be sleeping very comfortably, and if there is a lion who's done that to the cub, it is most likely this one. And what's so interesting is that he, of course, when he and Tinio arrived with the pride 2 days ago, in fact, it could have been Tinio, I suppose, not 2 days ago, about, I think, 3 or 4 days ago when they killed that buffalo, this guy came up and greeted all of the females in turn, and some of the cubs. He had a long interaction with the cubs, and Tinio sort of hung back a bit. And I think that was quite interesting. And something else I wanted to say about the emotional side of this and animals' emotions and what they think. I'm afraid I've forgotten what it was, but hopefully it'll come to me sometime. But that's a lovely discussion to have. Do animals feel emotion? Oh, I know exactly what it was. Kristen, the difficulty, of course, is that when we look at their faces, it's impossible to tell. And that's why I think there's this kind of disconnect, or that's why it's a bit difficult for us. Unless you know an animal intimately, it's difficult to know what they're feeling, of course, because we, as natural psychologists and natural readers of behavior, do so through the facial expression. It's why meeting somebody is so much more effective than reading an email from them. You can read from their faces exactly what they mean. You watch their eyes. Are they smiling with their eyes, or they're just fakely smiling with their mouths and that sort of thing? Because we have such expressive faces, that's how we read emotion. Animals like this, animals other than the primates, they do not have the musculature in the face to show any kind of emotion. So that lion that we're looking at now, he can show you anger by putting his ears back. He can show you anger by baring his teeth, I suppose. Well, a dog would do that more than a cat would. But further than that, you don't know if he's looking sad. You don't know if he's looking tired or sad or depressed. That's just what his face looks like, and he doesn't have the muscles to change that. He doesn't have an expressive mouth. And so it is difficult to interpret what they're feeling. But if you know an animal intimately, like many of you who have cats and dogs do, you can just tell. There is an unspoken communication that they give you, and then you know whether they're sad or miserable or in need of some love. John, great question from you, and I think it's an interesting one. You say, do I think it's strange that the male yesterday sought out the female who was looking for her cub, even though she wasn't in estrus? Do I think that maybe he had some form of understanding of what she was going through, of what she was trying to do? John, wow, I don't know. I mean, she wasn't in estrus. Now, we are told that when a pride comes into a lioness comes into estrus, she will seek out the male, and that the males, if the female isn't in estrus, they don't try and mate with them. So that's an interesting one. Now, that's the oldest female in the pride, and I'm not sure if she was the one looking for the cub yesterday. It is very interesting. She's having a bit of a scratch. Might be a little bit of mange. That is a lovely picture though, isn't it? And if you wanted to ascribe an anthropomorphic emotion to that cat, you'd be saying, well, she's looking into the distance, kind of thinking of happier times almost. She almost looks nostalgic, doesn't she? Which, of course, is nonsense, because we feel nostalgic for that cub, and now we're just simply ascribing an emotion to her, which may or may not be true. I'm going to move forward so we can just get rid of that pole in the way there. That is the only disadvantage to having the roof, and indeed why it took so long for us to construct these roofs, is because the poles do get in the way, I'm afraid. Now, there are another two lions through here, and I think maybe a couple of cubs. I don't know where the cubs are. Oh, there they are. Brian, is that okay for you? Or shall I angle better? I will angle better for you. For you, Brian, anything. Thank you. How's that? Hopeless. I just don't want to get too close to the male here. He's looking a little bit irritated, but he's okay now. There we go. The cubs are through there. All very cold. Now, do I think that they are affected by the loss of a sort of litter mate? Who knows? Who knows? Let's try and... What is their human equivalent? I mean, they're now 5.5 months. Beginning, I think, middle of June, the first bunch were born. We'll call ourselves at the middle of November now. July, August, September, October, November. So they're 5 months old. The oldest ones. And the youngest ones, 4.5 months, or 4 months old. And... Now we need to ask ourselves, that would be the kind of equivalent, I suppose, a one-year-old lion would be like just before puberty, say a 10-year-old human being, so half a year old, say a 5-year-old human being. Would a 5-year-old recognize the loss of a sibling? Absolutely. Would it feel an acute sense of pain and sadness? Absolutely it would. Would, therefore, these lions feel the same? I don't know. One can't help but think, especially in inclement, depressing weather like this, that perhaps they do. Perhaps there's a sense of where's Johnny? All right, we're going to sit here for a little bit and let's get Steph's impressions. The wizened old fellow, who's slightly younger than me, in the tent, let's get his impressions on animal emotions.
All right, and back to the tent to give James a bit of a breather and also to discuss a little bit of the emotional side of what's going on, and as well as the policy and the procedure that's going around at the moment around the cubs. Some of you have been asking that has the Sabi Sands been notified? Do they understand the seriousness of this? And, you know, what's being done about it? I can say that the Sabi Sands have absolutely been notified about what's going on through a reporting structure that we have down here on the ground. They know what's going on, and we're just waiting for sort of an official answer. But I would expect that it's going to be something along these lines, only because they treat most animals here the same. And I would expect that unless there were some unusual circumstances, that what I'm going to say now is probably just the default position. And that they try and have a hands-off policy here when it's quite obvious that there weren't any factors from directly affected from people. So there's a large chance that they will just say, you know, let nature take its course. You know, the cub will probably pass on in a little bit, or it won't, and it'll get better and rejoin the pride. They don't know what caused it. There wasn't any obvious human intervention here. And that is probably what we're most likely to see from this. Has it happened before? Many hundreds, possibly even many thousands of times, ranging across the board from, I've personally seen deformed elephant here with deformed hips and deformed back legs. I've seen many hundreds of cubs pass on in the last 17 years or so of working in the Sabi Sands. And the Sabi Sand has always had that same policy that let nature take its course unless there was an obvious human interaction that caused this injury. And they take it from there. Of course, these things are reviewed year by year and case by case, so there is a chance that an intervention will happen, but it's up to them to decide, and they definitely do know what's going on and where it is, and Juma understands where it is, Wild Earth understand where we are and, you know, what our place is over here and what we do. So that's basically what we're waiting to hear from today and possibly even in tomorrow. Although from the looks of that little cub, doesn't look like he's going to be lasting much longer. But then, as James was saying, these things are difficult to judge, and there's every chance that that something else happens, you know, and something miraculous happens. These things do happen. All right. Now, I was just wanting to comment a little bit more on James's discussion, which was very interesting, about human emotions and how we can sometimes put these emotions onto our pets and how there's an obvious connection between that. I mean, if you think about your own pets, as James was saying, your own cats and dogs, but even things like birds, hamsters, rats, snakes, you know, all the variety of pets that we have out there, everyone has a connection. And I personally feel that it's because a large portion of our brain, a large portion of how we judge reaction is based on facial expressions. We have a lot of brain power that is dedicated to specifically looking at faces. And because of that, we've developed this, I would say, almost an oversensitivity towards this type of thing. And we're very perceptive with subtle changes in a face. So what we perceive to be at least a smile or a gesture quite often is maybe subdued for that animal. They don't have that wide range of very deep emotion like we do, I believe anyway, but there definitely is emotion there. There definitely is a connection that we are perceptive to, not necessarily reciprocated though. So it's not necessarily that the animal can perceive how we are, except for, I believe, when we go and have a look at these animals, when you go and have a look at the physiology of these animals, they have a way of communicating with one another that is based on posture, that is based on facial expression, that's based on small sounds. They don't have a spoken language like we do. Well, at least none that we know of just yet, I suppose. And these animals do communicate very effectively. You will see, you know, just talking about lions and containing this, or keeping the thread going of lions and cubs, quite often lion cubs will just get up and follow their mother when their moms leave. But equally so, sometimes mom leaves and the cubs just stay put. Leopards are exactly the same. Sometimes the cubs go with, sometimes they stay put. If you walk into lion, if you bump into them in the bush, quite often the cubs will follow one female. Who decides who goes with which mother or with which lioness? It's all done through these subtle body, it's body language. It's all done through subtleties that I suppose if we studied a particular pride or a particular individual for long enough, we could maybe pick up on this. But I think it's all sort of highlighted by these coat patterns. When you go back to the lions in a little bit, have a look at those black lips that the lions have. They've got a black nose. Their eyes are uniformly colored except for the black pupil. Their gums are very pink. Their teeth are very white. And all of these, inside of their ears are rimmed. You can see the ear itself is not camouflaged. It's not meant to break the outside pattern. And I think that if you just watch them for long enough, you'll see that all of those subtleties start to play. Now, whether or not they are sensitive to it is what we are, is the question, I think, of the day for me. Whew. I'm going to contradict myself now and say that I don't think that the perception of our range of emotion is high, as high as ours. I'm going to say that there's subtleties that we have yet to understand. I think that they have got a very effective communication using body language and facial expression, and I think that we have yet to understand exactly what that means. I think that's what I want to say about that. That's what I believe anyway. Well, now, to talk about the weather again, because that's really what's ruling my life and keeping me inside this tent. It looks like it's still carrying on raining. The clouds, now that the sun is up, we would have expected the long-wave radiation that is being radiated from the sun off of the ground back onto the clouds would have lifted this cloud layer a little bit if it wasn't that thick, but it looks like it is a thick band of cloud. And I think when I'm on my own again here just now, I'm going to just realize how, go onto some website over here and realize just how bigger band of cloud it is. I know it's associated to a cold front that has just passed along the eastern borders of our country. And generally speaking, at this time of year, cold fronts do bring a little bit of rain. It's because they suck a bunch of moisture off of the ocean and dump it over the country, which is a good thing. We also have these two bands of pressure that play quite heavily in summer over the country. We have a low pressure cell that moves from the Indian Ocean onto our east coast. And we also have a low pressure cell that moves from the equator down to over Botswana and sometimes a little bit into South Africa that sucks a bunch of moisture out of the tropics in Central Africa as well. And so that brings it all in, which is quite nice. Can't wait to actually have them back over then. Now, Roger, you just asked me if a little bit more rain, can we expect a little bit more grass? And yes, absolutely, we can expect some more grass. In summertime here, after a couple of years of a lot of rain, the grass can actually get to almost hip height. And you can't actually walk with your feet in a normal gait, which is just lifting it slightly and moving one past another. You actually have to place your feet in the grass. Spaces between bushes get completely grown over by grass, and it becomes an almost impenetrable wall of vegetation in wet years here. You could drive through it, of course, but to walk through the bush here in deep summer between January and March after a lot of rain is a difficult thing. And you're really just stuck to game paths and open areas. The bush runs with water here. Totally different to how it's been for the last couple of years, and with particular emphasis on last year. Last year was one of the driest years in over 100 years in this particular area. And funny enough, it follows onto the back of a pretty wet decade. From 2000, the year 2000, all the way to the year 2009, there was a lot of water in the Kruger National Park. On average, the Kruger Park gets between 200 mils, which is about this much, and 450 mils, which is about that much. In really, really wet years, we'll have double that. So we'll have 1.5 meters of rain, which, let me just see that I'm not going. 1.5 meters is probably from the floor to my hand, whereas the normal rainfall is that much. And that gives you an idea of the difference. Last year, we had half of that. We had 150 millimeters of rain last year. That was that much, which is nothing. But what I am hoping for, at least anyway, is this year that we have a normal rainfall. So if we don't have an excessive rain, which will wash all the sand away and all the seeds and everything away, we're just looking for normal rainfall, about 400 mils of rain. That's about that much. That's what we're looking for this year. I suppose time will tell. Anyway, we're going to be going back over to James and those lions that are lying up in the rain.
Now, everybody, I just wanted to say, as this lioness, that lion gets up, that's not a lioness, you see it's got a mane, Brian. I wanted to add to what Steph was saying there about non-verbal communication, of course. That's exactly how these animals do it. And so I'm sure they do express some kind of information to each other non-verbally. And as he said, we have no idea what they're saying to each other. And as you look at that face, the only bits of expression that we read are the ears, and they're very clear to us. And I think that's probably A, because we do own domestic animals, and B, because we are somewhere deep in our genetic memory that ears forward posture of any animal indicates comfort, the ears back indicates threat, and so we're immediately on guard when an animal starts to put its ears back like that. So what's happened since you've been here? There's been huge action, everybody. That lion got up and moved 10 meters, 30 feet, yes, that is right, 30 feet to where it now sits. And what it's doing is going to go to sleep there now. And I think it got up just to go and have a bit of a smell, because it looks to me like all five lionesses are here. And I think one of them is definitely an estrus, and perhaps he's looking to see if he can't mate. Now, on that subject, Amber Eyes, of course, has been sort of coming in and out of estrus for, it seems to me like months. But she has failed so far as we can tell, to conceive. I don't know if she's here. Anyway, there's quite a lot of rain coming down. I'm just going to talk to Aubrey on the game drive quickly. Go ahead. As we look at Brian's very artistic shot there. Go again, Orbs. Here's the love and go. I'm just listening to Aubrey, everyone. He's telling me that the young cubs have just been found at the quarry on the firebreak. I'm going to quickly get Louise to get hold of Taylor and tell her that. Let's just quickly, Louise, can you quickly get hold of Taylor? All right, where should we go to the leopards, or do you want Taylor to go? I just don't know where Taylor is, everybody. So I'm just quickly going to give the location to Louise. They are on the firebreak at the quarry just south of Treehouse Dam. So that is going to Louise, through to Taylor, and she is now going to drive at great speed towards that area. I think we'll spend another sort of 10 or 15 minutes here, everybody, and then I think we'll press on and see what else we can see. That lion looked up because Brian's tent is flapping a little bit. I'm going to quickly tie Brian's tent in place. There you are.
Thank you.
Oh, now here's a lovely question here. Zoe, we're talking about emotions, human emotions and animal emotions, and you say, have I ever noticed jealousy amongst any animals? Absolutely I have, and certainly amongst, I've seen it with dogs and cats. Have I seen it with cubs? Well, I don't know. We've certainly seen them fighting over milk and over teats and trying to kind of get some kind of, fighting with each other over that. Whether they feel jealousy over emotion or not, I don't know. Certainly male lions feel jealousy for each other. It's a very interesting emotion, and I've read a little bit about its evolution, and we all know the feeling of jealousy is very uncomfortable. It makes us feel very horrible indeed, and one of the reasons we have it, apparently, and you can certainly see it in the animal kingdom, is so that we are guarded against our partners. So I think you'll find that it's almost non-existent, for example, in a species like bonobos, where they have a kind of totally open sexual policy where everybody mates with everybody else. Whereas in a species where that is not the case, lions, human beings, jealousy is that much more pronounced. And it's apparently some sort of evolutionary response to us, to our desire to maintain a kind of a pair bond, that we don't want to be upset. Because if you didn't feel jealousy, you wouldn't really mind if the neighbor next door decided your wife was better than his wife. It wouldn't be a problem. But because we feel that sense of jealousy, we're very protective over that, and in turn, therefore, of our children. So there are certainly many different strategies to it, but the more open the sort of sexual system is, or the mating system is, the less that jealousy, I think, will be displayed. Sorry, Lou, you're going to have to go again with that. Ah, Cindy, very good question about when or how a female will go into estrus. Would she go into estrus on the back end of losing just one cub, or would she have to lose all of her cubs in order to go into estrus? I think the answer, Cindy, is very much that she would have to lose all the cubs. I don't think it would be just one. I think it would be all of them. Because, of course, if she came into estrus now, let's say this female who's lost her cub or is about to lose her cub came into estrus now, it would be pointless for her to come into estrus again, because it would mean that she'd stop caring for the other two cubs. Resources would be diverted to new cubs, and that would be obviously disastrous for the ones that are living still. So no, they would only come into estrus once all of them were dead. So Taylor, just to keep you updated, is hieing her way towards those little leopard cubs. With any luck, we'll have them very soon, and that will be a very cheerful a cheerful addition to this morning that has been a little bit somber. Brian and I were just saying when we were off air that the atmosphere here is one that is somber, especially with the black cuckoo calling in the background saying... I'm so sad. Kat, an interesting one again. I mean, I think we could talk about this for days, you say. Do I think there's a reason that the rest of the pride isn't lying with the cub until it passes? The reason is that it gives them no advantage at all. Gives them absolutely zero advantage to be there, lying in a place they have for a long time. They came hunting here, they brought the rest of the pride, that cub couldn't keep up, and they left it. That's how lions operate. Certainly get up and didn't move, and so they've left it. I don't know that I'm pretty sure there isn't a cognizant acknowledgement that the cub is going to die, and therefore they should leave it. It's simply a pragmatic approach to, we have to move, we need to go hunting, so we're moving out of this area, we've been out of here for too long, anybody who stays behind is going to get lost there. That's why. So when we go on to the emotional side of things, I think that there's definitely a disconnect between what is cognizant and what is simply an inherent emotional response. So while there might be an attitude of somberness here, there's no, for an animal to spend time with comforting a companion that's going to die, it implies almost some kind of appreciation of death and what it means. It implies an appreciation almost that there is you've used the term passing, for example. I mean, that's very much a human term based on our religious outlook on life, which says that there is a hereafter. I don't think these animals think like that at all. The closer you get to primates, or the closer you get to human beings through the primates, then the more you see that kind of thing. And apparently with the chimpanzees, they will absolutely go and be around an animal that's about to die. Now, what evolutionary advantage does that confer? Well, what it does is it confers some kind of social bond to the whole troop. Is there any disadvantage to doing it? No, probably not. Is there a disadvantage to them doing it? Absolutely. They don't eat. They're unable to move away from places where they could be dangerous. It could be dangerous for the other cubs, and so they will take the pragmatic approach and leave, because there's nothing they can do for that cub. So it's an interesting one. That's why they don't stay with the cub. They have no appreciation, I don't believe, of certainly not a hereafter. They definitely don't have an appreciation of the finality, I don't think, of death until it actually happens. It's quite interesting. When you get into that narrow band of what's going on, I think that's where it becomes completely impossible to decide what they feel, what they think, and what's happening there. But it's such a lovely discussion, isn't it? And I think it's very interesting, Kat, that we as human beings, of course, use the term passing. We are very reticent to say died, dead. We say things like they've passed on, they've passed away. Well, you might say they've popped their clogs if you particularly kicked the bucket. But those are to the other side, of course. Passing, passed on, implies a sense of a hereafter, which, of course, I don't think that there is an appreciation of in something like the Nkuhuma pride. Wonderful discussion, everyone. Thank you. Fascinating indeed. All right, we're going to, I think, probably move on from here in the next 5 minutes, unless there is some burning desire from the general populace that we should stay here watching these flat kitties. Might come back and see them a little bit later. So let's spend another 5 minutes here, and then we'll push on and see what else we can find. It is very somber here indeed, however. And also cold. You know, the somberness that we are interpreting might simply be that these lions are cold. And Turtle, yeah, I have to agree with you in some ways. You say it's somber because we're feeling somber about things. We've had an emotional time the last few days. And you say if we were happy, well, these lions would still be lying here. But instead of talking about the somberness and sadness and the emotion of the situation, we'd be saying, oh, look, they look so miserable because it's cold and it's wet and it's rainy and they're behaving just like cats. And we certainly wouldn't be ascribing all sorts of emotions to them as we are now. It's a very good point. Thank you, Turtle. Brian, I just must say at this stage, is extremely comfortable. He's got himself very nicely in his tent. And the southeast wind is having no effect on him at all. So we'll sit here until Taylor gets to the leopards and then I think we'll press on. That's interesting. Look at that. Look at that. That lioness has been mating. See the biting on the back of the neck there? That's very interesting. That's from the male biting her on the back of the neck. Now, that's odd, because I thought she was the oldest female who's already got cubs. Something interesting going on there. Maybe that's just a bashing from the male, maybe just a fight. But those wounds are in exactly the kind of position that they would be if she'd been mating. Right, that's very interesting. We'll try and figure out what's going on here. In the meantime, Steph is in the tent still. Let's go and get his impressions on life and that sort of thing, his philosophizing, and then we'll head across to the leopards.
I'd like to offer a different opinion on what those marks were on the back of that lioness's neck. While they seem to be in the right place for that male to be biting over there, there's an alternative to that as well, and it looks like they have been grooming one another. Quite often lions lying close together will groom one another, and I've watched them pop ticks with their teeth, and in particular in easy to get to reach places on the back of the neck and on the flanks. Quite often they will groom each other. It's called allo-grooming, and it's a way for them to strengthen bonds between one another, where two lioness or even two males will sit and groom one another, and that popping of the ticks creates a little splash of blood there, and that's what it could also be. I'm not discounting James's theory, I'm just offering another alternative there as to what it could possibly be. Without closer inspection, it is going to be difficult to see. I've got this interesting story. I was at home over the weekend, and myself and my son found this beetle, and he picked it up. This is called a steel beetle, and he got nipped on his finger by this particular mandible, and it's just such a nice thing. We were going for a walk. He's just developing the observation skills of a very interested young toddler, and is picking up everything, and of course learning with it that some things need to be picked up with some caution. And he instead of putting his finger down on it, so how you would normally pick up this beetle is you put your finger down on it just like that, and then you pick it up with your two other fingers like this, and then you pick it up and you can have a look at it. He just picked it up and was holding it, and of course the steel beetle then bit him on the finger, much to his Definitely wasn't to his delight. He ended up roaring his disapproval at this beetle and I think flung it into the bush higher than the trees around him. All right, now I know Taylor is busy rushing off to see if she can find those leopard cubs, and I think James is going to spend a little bit more time with those lions before moving on. What else could we expect around Juma today? Yesterday on the walk was quite interesting. We bumped into a herd of elephant that had come from looked like they had come from the Manyeleti side, which lies off to the north of us. They were very, very skittish. And it was quite interesting to see their behavior. For the last couple of months, elephant have been relatively calm. We've bumped into a lot of elephant, many hundreds of elephant on walk in the last couple of months. But yesterday's elephant gave us a little bit of an uneasy feeling. They were incredibly alert about what was going on in their surroundings. And literally, we just stepped on a branch. The wind was blowing from them to us. They couldn't have smelt us. We stepped on one branch. The matriarch lifted up her head. She looked straight into the bush where we were hiding. She didn't see us. We were very, very quiet. She then, without a sound, turned around and ran off in the other direction, followed by the rest of her herd. They just disappeared like smoke into the grass. And I can only think that these elephants are coming out of the Kruger National Park, where they don't necessarily see people as often as the elephants who frequent the Sabi Sands and the other private game reserves that are attached to the national park. You see it sometimes with these elephants that come out of the national park. They just got this nervousness about them. They've got this anxiety about them. And I think it's because they can pick up on the activity, the human activity around here. And this particular matriarch was probably just making use of the grass that is coming up in this particular area. Right here where we are at Juma, and just a little bit around in the surrounding area, probably about 50 miles by 50 miles, if that big even, has gotten the first rains of the season in this area about 3 weeks ago. And that has caused a bit of a flush in the vegetation that's a lot healthier than other areas in the Kruger Park that I've been seeing over the last couple of months. And is, of course, a draw card for them, which is nice. Now, Chris, I think, in Texas, excuse me, I was just a little bit muffled through my ear. You just wanted to know, Price. Price, you just wanted to know, is the drought a yearly thing or is this something a little bit more uncommon? So, Price, we have a dry season and a wet season. We have a winter and a summer in this particular area as well, but it doesn't get that cold. I think we go down to a minimum of around about, at its coldest, we'll get to zero, to freezing point of water. Quite often, we're around about the 50 degrees centigrade, the 30 to 50 degrees centigrade marker. During summer and winter, we very, very rarely dip below freezing. But we definitely have a rainy season. Our rainy season is from January through to the end of March, and our driest season is from May, well, not really, it's our May, June, and July is our driest season here. So we have a wet season and a dry season. Most years, we will go down to a very small amount of rain during those dry seasons. We still get precipitation most months here, except last year, but we definitely get rain in every month over here. Last year was significant in that it rained half of the expected rain that we were supposed to have here, and was also the driest year recorded in the last 110 years. Now, although that sounds like a lot, in terms of climate, it's a blink of an eye. They tend to run in decades here, the wet seasons and the dry seasons. So you'll go from a wet season around the turn of a decade to a dry season mid-decade. And that sort of has been the pattern since the 1970s or so, where this pattern in this particular area was observed, I should say. So it goes from round about the turn of a decade, so, you know, the 0 years, you know, let's just use lately 2009, 10, 11 were wet years, 2012 were dry years. And so, you know, we're just coming out of that now. I think we're going into 2000, or the middle of this particular decade now, and we've expected the drought to come. Will it last another year? Quite possibly. There's nothing that says that the droughts can't carry on here for successive years. And although last year was a particularly dry year and we're expecting a normal year of rain this year, you know, Mother Nature will let us know at the end of the summer. We'll see what happens. I'm personally expecting just a normal rainfall this year. Around about 450 mils of rain in this particular area, maybe pushing it up to 500 or 600 mils of rain. That's about that much, not too much, a couple of inches, really. That's all we need to have it lush and thick and green and heavy with humidity over here. We're not that far away from the coast, in actual fact. We're probably about 200 miles from the Indian Ocean, 200 kilometers, less than 200 miles away from the Indian Ocean as we sit over here. We've literally just got the stretch of the Kruger National Park and then Mozambique, and Mozambique borders onto the Indian Ocean. So a lot of our weather actually comes from the sea. Some days, even when it rushes in over the land, you can actually imagine that you can smell sea salt or that sea breeze that you get too close to the sea. At least I can anyway, I don't quite know. David, have you ever smelt the sea breeze out here?
I can't say I have, sir.
You know, David hasn't smelt it. He hasn't been here long enough, is it? All right. I mean, this is probably one of my favorite books at the moment. It's a book on insects in South Africa. And in it has got the most unbelievable collection of different insects. And I'm hoping that this year we see some of not only my long-term favorites, but also some new insects. These are all weevils. We found one on walk the other day, and for the life of me, I could not identify it. I have a feeling it was this one here. But since it doesn't occur here at all, I'm absolutely wrong. It's one of these eternal things that I have, being wrong about which weevil that we have here. Now, James, you've asked me, does the size of a spider have any relation to the amount of years, how old they get? That's an interesting question there, James. Let me just think about that for a bit. Yes, I would say yes. And I'm going to be using the example of the baboon spiders that we find in South Africa, or the tarantulas, as they're commonly known around the world, or megalomorphs. You get some female megalomorph or baboon spider that live for up to 35 years in this particular area. And that's a long time for a spider. And they're big. They can get as big as my hand. Large, long-lived spiders. I would say that the smaller of the spiders, while they do live a long time, some species of spider get to 5 years quite easily. Most spiders, in actual fact, live longer than 5 years. I would say that absolutely the size of a spider has an influence on how long it can live. With the larger the spider and the more sedentary the spider, in other words, the more the spider just lives in one place and doesn't move around at all, and probably underground, the longer that spider will live. Now, Taylor has finally gotten to her destination. I don't quite know what she's found there, but I'm sure she's dying to tell you.
So we finally got to the spotted cats, thanks to Aubrey. However, it's just little Hosanna and Shongile, that are tucked away trying to keep warm on this very chilly morning. And I'm uncertain as to where Karula is. Perhaps she is out looking for something to eat. And it's actually a good day to go off hunting because it's so cold, it's cloudy. The pitter-patter of the rain is muffling sounds, and of course the wind that we have occasionally got sort of gusting through, well, that'll help muffle the sound too. Hello. He's turning into a handsome fella, don't you think? He's really looking lovely, but very miserable. Wet, cold. I don't think hungry, because they've had something to eat. Now I'm wondering if, I'm not sure if Karula took whatever she may have killed the other day up into the tree, or she had it on the ground. And I wonder if the reason that they left is because maybe a hyena came through and stole it, because that could have been a possibility. We know that happened the last time. Oh, can you hear the birds now alarming? And little Hosanna responding, just keeping a close eye on the drongo that was shouting at them. But they don't seem to be too fussed by that. Isn't that sweet? He's resting his head up on the log. Now, if you have perhaps just joined the show, we are on a live safari and I'd love to hear from you this morning. So you're welcome to send any questions through to Twitter, and you can do the hashtag SafariLive. And if you don't have Twitter, don't worry, we have an alternative. You can send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. Now, we're not going to get too close to these cubs. We're going to keep a slight distance. Now, James is commenting, saying how miserable these cubs look. You're indeed correct. It's quite sad. But luckily, they've got the big fluffy coats to keep them nice and warm, much like this big green one I have on me. Slightly waterproof. However, I still think that they're warmer than what I'm feeling at the moment. Now, hopefully Karula will come back. Aubrey picked up on some tracks of her, and they didn't seem too old. So she obviously just moved them, and they were playing in the road by the looks of the footprints, and dropped them off here. And now, well, little ones, you're not allowed to go venturing off. Let's hope they don't go too far. Maybe he's just going to reposition himself next to his sister. There's little Shongile. Oh no, he's using the luxury facilities at the moment. I always laugh because it doesn't matter what cat it is. It's a very specific posture that they go into. Shungile's not having any of it. She's curled herself up nicely. Maybe her brother will come up and curl next to her and they can keep each other warm. Now there's quite a few vehicles coming into the sighting, so you're probably going to hear a bit of motors starting and stopping. Now, Crystal, you were wondering why they don't snuggle. They may, but you know, I suppose Hosanna is now getting to that age where he doesn't need his sister anymore. He's quite happy to sort of venture out on himself. They do play together, of course, and they will snuggle, but for the moment, well, he's not interested. And I'm sure, though, Shongile would appreciate it if her brother came over and gave her a bit of a cuddle. As it's been raining like this since yesterday afternoon, it just started at about 5 o'clock. The clouds started coming over again and the drizzle started. And we, like I said earlier, we didn't have like a torrential downpour. It's just been a hard drizzle pretty much the entire night. And it seems to be letting off a little bit, slightly brighter. But they have forecasted that we get a couple of inches of rain over the next few days. And that's because Johannesburg had a mighty storm about two nights ago, and it flooded quite a bit of the area in Johannesburg. And we suspect that it's that weather that's coming towards us very slowly. But let's hope that we keep the gradual rain, though, and we don't get a torrential downpour. That won't be fun for anyone. Especially not these cats that don't seem to enjoy the water as much as perhaps the lions or the cats of the delta in Botswana. They are obviously much more equipped to the wet terrain. Hosanna seems to be a little bit unsettled. I think he's probably done waiting around now and looks like he's getting a bit impatient. He keeps looking over his shoulder, perhaps hoping to hear the row that mom will give off to let them know that she has returned. But they seem very relaxed with us, which is really nice. They're only 9 months old, and in this sort of situation, it's important that we give them space because mom is not around here. But they haven't shown any signs that they're uncomfortable with us. So we'll try not to move around too much and just sit nice and quietly. Now, Bobby Chase, you were wondering, and we've been chatting about it quite a bit, when these little cubs are going to start hunting for themselves. Well, Hassan is going to get, he's probably going to get pushed out when he gets to about a year and a half, maybe 18 months. The boys seem to move off earlier. And I think young Shongile will probably hang around with mom for a little bit longer. It may depend on how tolerant Karula is also going to be towards Hosanna. But just in my experience, the male cubs never seem to stay around for too long. They always disappear. So they should start joining in relatively soon, in the next couple of months or so. When they get to about a year or 2 months, a year and 3 months, they're going to probably start going out. They're going to grow very quickly now as well. You'll be surprised in the next 4 or 5 months how these little leopard cubs are going to double in size. And before you know it, Hosanna will be the same size as his mother. Well, Shongile's will have a bit of growing to do still. And then it's sad. Then it gets really tough for Mr. Hosanna. Now you can see that he's now given up on looking over his shoulder for mom and gone back to trying to keep warm. Now, Turtle, good morning, Turtle. You were wondering how old will it be until these leopard cubs mate? Now, and like you said, not you don't mean with each other. So we've just said that Hassan is probably going to move out relatively soon, probably in the next 9 months or somewhere around there. Before he reaches about 2 years old, he'll go off. And he's going to have to wait quite some time. I don't know if you maybe tuned in, it was about a week and a half ago, where we had Nkanyeni sort of acting very amorous around quarantine. And well, quarantine doesn't really know what to do, as he's quite young. He's only about 4 years old, so he's still learning the ropes. So I reckon anywhere between after about 4 years old, if he's very lucky and he's potentially found an area where there's not maybe a big male leopard, which is unlikely, but there's always a possibility in nature, well, then he could start mating them. But it's a lot later in life. And, young Shongile, she comes into estrus anywhere from about 2.5 years or so. So she could mate straight away. Also unlikely, though. Probably another year or so, I reckon, when she reaches about 3 years in age or so, somewhere around there, she'll probably start to act quite amorous and look for the attention of a big male leopard. Hello, Clinton. I believe you've just started watching. It's lovely to have you. Now, you're wondering how old these two cubs are. They are 9 months old. They're growing up very, very quickly. You can already start to see Hosanna, though he's sleeping now, but when he does stand up, he's really growing into himself. He's a lot bigger than his sister, much stockier as well as being taller. And Shongile is still very slight. Now it's going to be really interesting to see where Hosanna goes once he gets old enough and can go off on his own. I mean, I've seen a leopard cub at about a year and 2 months. A mother died and, well, it carried on and he survived and he's still going strong. I think he's probably might not be as big as what he should be because he hasn't had all the nutrients. But he used to catch tortoises and scrub hares and birds and eat all those types of things. But they can go off at quite a young age. But poor Hassan is going to have to find a gap somewhere. And I can only imagine the first few years of his solitary life will be spent in and amongst other male and other female leopards' territories, just trying to stay hidden, not draw too much attention to himself. Otherwise, he'll get himself into a lot of trouble. Especially, you wouldn't want him bumping into the Anderson male. That would not be a good time for him. So he may even move right out of this area. He may go into the Kruger National Park, towards Cheetah Plainside. Maybe he goes through the southern sector of the Sabi Sands, past Londolozi and Singita, all the way down to the Sabi River. And I remember I've seen Sindile down there, so we know that distance is not a challenge for leopards. They are able to cover huge amounts of ground in just a really short period of time. So it'll be interesting to see and follow. And this is the amazing thing, is that we are able to follow, and we'll see where he's going to end up one day. And that's thanks to the Panthera project that's done in this area, as well as through other parts of Africa, where we track the movements of these leopards. And of course, we don't have any GPS devices on them, in case you were wondering. It's really just by sight, and you learn the specific markings that a leopard has, from the spot pattern to the pearl necklace that they have on their chest, any scars or nicks out of the ears, or like Tingana, a smiley face on his shoulder that his sort of rosettes have formed, which is quite unique. And we're able to continue following them, even if they move away, and keep getting updates as to how they're doing. Now, Anna Marie, you want to know if there's any theory behind why female leopard cubs leave their mothers earlier than male leopard cubs. Now, I've had the complete opposite experience. I've seen it where male leopard cubs actually leave before the females. And the reason for this is that the females will often actually chase another leopardess out of their territory to open up a territory next door to her own, for her daughter. So that's quite typical. So typically, you often see interactions between mom and daughter for much longer than you will see with a mother and her male cub. So I think it's the opposite. I've seen male leopards, like I said, leaving from about a year and 2 months, and in the odd case where the mother had died. But an average age, and this of course is just my opinion, is normally anywhere between a year and a half and a year and 8 months. They usually move off, and you'll start getting a bit distance, and the mothers usually start to act a little bit more aggressively towards the males. And I've seen a leopard cub, a female, and her mother interacting right up until this one particular leopard was about 3 years old. They ate off the same carcass. She went off and she started developing her own territory, but they were still interacting every now and then. So I think, Anna Marie, I think maybe just if you swap it around, I don't think the theory then would be the female tends to stay with the mother the longest, just purely because she'll actually physically force another leopard out of the area to open up a potential territory right next door to hers for her daughter. And well, the boys, fortunately, they don't get any of that, any of those privileges, and they've got to go off on their own. And I think life for a leopard male is quite tough. We see it being tough for the male lions, but at least the male lions, and well, lions in general, are social, so they form coalitions. But when you're on your own, new to the world, not sure as to what's going on, you know, always had mom bring you food, I think life must be quite daunting. And I've seen quite a few young male leopards coming through, you know, sort of lost and not sure where to go. Hello, Judy, thank you. Now, obviously, every leopard, every animal is different. And Judy H has said that Karula's male sons always seem to be mama's boys, and that they always stay around till over the age of two. And that's quite interesting, because the leopards that I've ever come across, it's always the boys that get shoved to the side, sadly. Well, like it is, not sadly, it's nature. And the little girls hang on for a little bit longer. But that's nice to see. So we'll see what happens with, of course, with both of with these two. And it'll be quite interesting. So perhaps he will stick around for longer. But it's not a very common thing. Like I said, out of all the leopards I've seen when they've had cubs, it's always been the boys that have been chased away. So this will be the first time for me, which was wonderful. You're supposed to have exceptions to all the rules out here. And Karula obviously hasn't read the same books as that I have, and that's okay. I can learn something from Karula. Now, I hope she does make a return. Jean-Hu, does it seem to you like the rain is stopping slightly? It actually is looking not so bad. Still horrible clouds in the sky, though. Now, I don't think we're going to be able to sit here for too long, I'm afraid. It's a very, very difficult spot where these cubs are sitting. And I know that There are quite a few guides who'll be quite excited to come and have a look at them, but I think we'll be able to stay here for a couple more minutes. But fast asleep. But still listening to what's going on around them. And as they sit here by themselves, and they have these little cat naps, they have to be quite vigilant, not necessarily with their eyes, but they need to listen out to what's going on around them. Because if a male leopard or another leopardess comes through, even a hyena, they need to act very quickly and, of course, try and get away. Even, not even a carnivore, it could be a troop of baboons that would come through. We've seen it with Tundi. And, well, then they're going to have to run very, very quickly and look for some shelter. Not a unique marking that he's got on sort of the back of his neck, how there seems to be a lack of rosettes. Can you see that there? It's almost like a big creamy white patch. That's beautiful, actually. I don't think I've ever really seen that on a leopard before. That's a very distinctive marking. And quite a big rosette, how those spots have all sort of joined up. Very interesting. So there we go, and that's what we look at on these cats, and of course the leopards with the most beautiful coats out in the bush. You look for these unique markings. Quarantine has got the airstrip going down the, or the landing strip going down the back of his tail. Of course we know that Tingana's got that lovely smiley face. Karula's got the big wow, the W on her forehead. And these two are also going to have their own special markings. I'm going to jump on the radio very quickly. Now, earlier I was talking about how we don't have the GPS collars on the various animals, and I know that James from Ireland was wondering why we don't use the GPS collars. And then you've also, and you're wondering if it's because we don't want to have too much of contact with the animals, and that you have noticed a couple of collars on the animals before. Now, you're quite correct in saying that. Now, about 15 years ago, between 10 and 15 years ago, it was a big trend in the Greater Kruger area to try and monitor various animals. So they put collars on elephants, they put collars on wild dogs, they collared lions, and an array of different species of animals. And they did this because it was experiments that they were trying to figure out. They wanted to track vast movements was a big one. So between the various animals, where what their movements are. Are they migrating? Is it seasonal? Or different things. And with the wild dogs, of course, it was quite important because we know that they're an endangered species. So any information you can get about a wild dog is super important. Lions, they were doing a lot of projects to see if any of them were being affected by tuberculosis or in feline AIDS. So they were tracking individual prides. I remember this quite clearly. I read a document about the report and the study. And so that they needed to keep track of the various prides. And the thing is that you don't have to necessarily have the GPS collars on them. But if they disappear for a day or two and you can't pick up on them, then they can move kilometres and kilometres or miles and miles away. And to try and relocate on them and lose a week, that's, you know, days that you're wasting away that you could use for valuable research and data collecting. But since then, they have taken the collars off to sort of try the as intrusive sort of approach to the GPS collaring. So they've removed quite a few off the elephants. We used to see a lot of the elephants coming in from Kruger with these collars on, but I believe that not many of them were working. So we used to have to report them, and then they would come, the vets would come in and dart them, remove the collars, and then, of course, wake them up and send them on their way. And there's a pack called Toulon Pack of Wild Dogs that's down, it lives sort of, where do you live? Between the Sand River and the Sabi River. And it loves those areas, or that pack, and it's quite a big pack. There must be at least 25 of them. And one of the males has actually got a collar on, and I believe that they've got no interest in taking that collar off. They've been tracking the Toulon Pride Pack for many, many, many years, and he doesn't seem to be too bothered by it at all. What they might do, though, and something that's quite interesting, is the collar sizes are now changing. So from 15 years ago, when they were large and bulky, they're now sort of downscaling them quite a bit and making them more slender, not as obvious. And of course, that'll have a positive impact on the animal too, is that it won't bother them as much anymore. I'm not a fan of it, though. I think this Panthera project, I think they're getting it right. Just sort of observing them, we as the guides out in the industry, obviously they have people specifically following the animals around as well, and we just report on the information. So as we're sitting here, I don't know, I think Kirsty will probably be putting in all the info for the Panthera on who we saw, did they have a kill, was it on the ground, was it in the tree, was the mother present, and all these various things, and we send this data through and we get reports for the entire Sabi San, because there are a lot of different lodges that are involved. Now, and this is something that I actually quite enjoyed. And in the Eastern Cape, we used to have, I'll just quickly chat. I'm really intrigued by this GPS conversation. And I think we've got a couple of minutes here. In the Eastern Cape, we used to have GPS collars on the rhinos, and that was purely from a monitoring perspective because it is so dense there. It's mountainous with rivers and valleys, and the vegetation is so thick that you can't even penetrate 5 meters through it in the summer months. We used to keep tabs on our rhinos just when we couldn't see them, and poaching, unfortunately, was quite high in that area. And a question that I used to get asked quite often, and I'm sure James and Steph and Brent and Jamie have had the same thing, is that we often had guests asking, why don't we just track the animals so that it would make it easier for us to spot them? And I think that takes the fun out of it. And also, a GPS collar on an animal does not guarantee that you're going to see them. We've had it before. We're tracking the rhinos, looking for the black rhino to see if they were okay. We knew exactly how far away they were from us, but we could not even see it because the vegetation was so thick. So yeah, that's why one of the reasons why we don't do it. And I don't think I would ever want to work on a property where they just track the animals. I think it really does take the fun out of it. How do you think, Jandre? Then becomes a bit of a zoo, hey? It's not great. So this is wonderful. Some days we see lots of animals, and well, some days we don't see anything. And that's just how the bush goes. Shame, little ones, you're cold and waiting for mum to come back. Now, Christian, you are wondering how long these cubs will be left alone for. It depends on how and where, if their mother makes a kill, and how far away it is. So she could be gone for a couple of days. It's not uncommon. They would have had a nice feast on whatever the Karula took down yesterday or the day before. And they've been eating so that they don't look particularly hungry. But it's very, very normal. I mean, I've seen a leopard once leave her cub in the same spot for a week. Well, that cub obviously was starving. But mom eventually came back and fetched it and took it off to an impala kill where they feasted away. And we see it with lions too. I've also seen it where sometimes cubs go missing, they get lost, or mom has intentionally left them in the spot. Maybe she's only on her own and she doesn't have a pride. Then she's got a hard job ahead of her to go and look for food. And that's, of course, what mom's around for, is mom's there to also protect the cubs, but she's responsible for feeding them. So if she keeps coming back every couple of hours to check on them, well, then she's not going to have very much of a chance to successfully capture something. And sometimes these hunts take hours of planning. It doesn't always just happen in a matter of minutes. Now, I want to just have a chat on the radio, sort of find out who's coming. Everyone has just left all of a sudden. Does anyone know how many vehicles are coming to the sighting with Shungile and Hosana? Okay, copy. Okay, well, it doesn't seem like 100 people are racing in this morning. So we shall sit here for a little bit longer until we get kicked out. Not that anyone's going to really physically kick us out. I'm just joking, of course. So what we'll do is we'll hang around for a little bit and hope that Karula's going to come back. But for the meantime, let's go over to Steph, who's in the tent.
Yes, and I'm finally playing with this little microscope that James is so fond of. And I must be honest, this is the second time that I'm having a go at this microscope, and I'm enjoying it so much. There's just so much you can learn and see. But before we jump into what I want to show you underneath this table, I just want to amend my previous statement about the spider's longevity to James. So the biggest spiders, they do live the longest. The megalomorphs, the baboon spiders or tarantulas, they definitely have the longest lifespan, and it would seem that it's connected to their size. Most other spiders, I originally said, live around about 5 years, and while we do have a large portion of spiders that do get to 5 to 10 years, by far and wide, the majority of spiders live and die and mate and lay their eggs and do their things within an 18-month period, so definitely longer than a year. Probably find that it's between 12 months and a year. A growing season, in other words. Some spiders get between 5 and 10 years, with the longest lived spiders going up to about 30 years in captivity. So just wanted to clear that up. Now, we have got the most unbelievable thing here. That, what we're looking at, is a buffalo thorn, a fairly common plant that we find out here. And you can see that it's flowering. It's flowering in these clusters. Now, yesterday, while we were walking around in the bush, we smelt a carcass. And for the life of us, between David, myself, and Herbert, we could not find what had died in this particular area. But every time we came past this place, it would smell, and we'd searching. A little bit later on in the walk, I heard this buzzing, not from the same place, a different place. When we investigated what was making this buzzing noise, there was a whole colony of flies, the regal blowflies or carrion flies, flies that are normally associated with carcasses, were all feeding and pollinating on the buffalo thorn's flowers. So this particular buffalo thorn is pollinated mainly by flies. And those flowers, as pretty as what they are, and I'm going to show you underneath the microscope now, have a distinct carrion-like smell. And we could only imagine that yesterday's smell that was wafting out of the bush was because there was a buffalo thorn in flower in the area where we were. It is a pong, I tell you. And obviously the smell is attracting these flies, which come in mass to come and pollinate the flower. And there is the flower. I must say, let's get them just a little bit closer for you. There you go. There's one there. It is a little bit wet, which is giving it that sheen. And that's what you're seeing at the moment there in the center of the screen. One has already flowered just to the below of the center. You can see that the ovum have started to swell. And that is where the buffalo thorn's fruit will come from. The fruit we can actually eat. The flowers smell like carrion. They are pollinated by flies and are just unbelievable. Just have a look at the detail on this little flower. That is amazing. Like I say, James in this microscope, quite interesting. Quite a sensitive little thing, this actually. Ah, yes. And off to the right-hand side of the screen, you can actually see a leaf, hang on mate, I'll just get my direction right, there you go, that has quite obviously been eaten by something. Now, from what I understand about insects, beetles eat center of leaves, caterpillars eat from the outside in, so this looks like some type of beetle has fed on the leaves of this buffalo thorn. And has led to those very distinctive holes that we're seeing there in the leaf itself. Wow, this is lovely. Let's go back to that seed. that seed is still brand new. In actual fact, you can see the remnants of the flower just above it. And then, of course, the flower with its male pollen-bearing part sticking off to the side. Looks like there's six per flower. Very, very, very cool. See what else is on this particular flower, or on this plant, I should say, we can have a look at. Apparently there's there's a spider web there as well. Wow. Now, that's quite interesting because those spider webs look like anchor webs. So those spider webs look like the anchor web that a spider will just plant as a safety line, basically, when moving from one part of the flower to another. My feeling is they were probably planted there by a crab spider. Crab spiders hunt on flowers and particularly fond of bees and flies. And I think what's happened in this particular case is that the mass of flowers that smell like carrion attracting those blowflies or those carrion flies. Let me show you what those flies look like. They are horrifying. We were with a couple yesterday in a buffalo carcass that was just most unbelievably disturbing thing. Let me show you what they look like. So there's a crab spider. That is what I expected to be on this particular flower. It's a female crab spider with a male crab spider, much smaller than what she is, holding a bee by the head. That is what I'm expecting, has laid those lines, those safety lines, on this particular buffalo thorn's fruit. And this is the fly that we were looking at yesterday. It was this fly here that had pollinated, or is busy pollinating, the buffalo thorn. And that is what I think has been being hunted by these crab spiders, at least anyway. Now, Alexandra, you've asked me, is there anything here related to the durian fruit? Now, I know that the durian fruit smells like a rubbish bin or a refuse bin that's been left out in the open. I have tasted one before, and it was not too bad. I mean, it's not something that I'd go and buy in the shop, of course, and the smell that emanates from these fruit is just something unbelievable. The closest that comes out here, other than this buffalo thorn, which I actually didn't know smelt like carrion, is the Stapelia family of plants. They are the carrion flowers. They don't smell like refuse dumps. They do smell like carrion as well, also pollinated by flies. They're these thick, fleshy-looking plants that just resemble something that's just rotting and smelling like rotting stuff down here. As for refuse, I suppose a wet hyena comes close to smelling like a rubbish dump, and a durian fruit, that is about as that, or a wild dog that's been lying in a puddle. They can be quite smelly. But as for fruit, no fruit smells like that durian that I know of, at least anyway, in South Africa. Now, I picked this up the other day as well while I was here. This is a piece of quartz, and it's got a nice break to it, and by that I mean, look at that crystal facet, those two parallel lines that are running along it. Now, quartz, or silicon dioxide, precipitates out of water, and quite often they get these faults in them, and you can see that there's a fault right there, and into that fault will go water. And if we just get the light right here, I'm almost sure I'll be able to show you what grabbed my attention when I picked this one up. Is there's water inside here that is refracting light. Very difficult to show you, although there we come close. You can see the light coming off of that, but it's throwing off the most unbelievable rainbow colors. I'm gonna try and see if I can find it for you. No, not having any luck with that one today. It is very pretty. Let's just see if I can see it with my naked eye under this type of light. No luck there, David. No luck. Let's see if we can put it underneath the microscope and maybe a little bit more of a direct light source. There we go. All right. There you can see the rainbows coming off of the water that's stuck inside this crystal. Isn't that unbelievably pretty? Excuse my crusty fingers coming into the shot there. It is muddy out here today. But there you go. There you can see the rainbow refraction from the water stuck in the crystal itself, and that is what caught my eye while we were walking through the bush. That is water stuck inside a quartz crystal. Nice, eh? I know, it looks like a piece of opal, to be quite honest with you. So it's taking pride of place on my desk in my room, which has a fantastic collection of a whole bunch of different things. This is pride of place for now. All right, so that's what I have to say right now to you for that. I'm going to send you over to one of the other two and enjoy yourself.
Everybody, we've been singing a lot in the rain, of course, because it's very cold. We're heading south-east now into the driving rain. Well, it's not very driving, but it is misty and cold. Now, I do apologize for the fact that you haven't seen us for a long time, although I've no doubt the leopards and Steph kept you entertained. It is that we have got a little problem with our signal. We've only got one functioning tower at the moment. There it is, Brian. We've been following that bird. But unfortunately, we haven't been able to film it because, of course, Brian is basically in a house on the back of this car, but now it's parked in a place that we can get it. Isn't that gorgeous? It's the Bataleer, the juvenile Bataleer that lives around here. We're just off Drakensberg Road, which is the eastern corner of Juma, and we're close to the south, and his parents have a nest not too far from here. And he's just gone to the loo. Wonderful. Probably hear the pitter patter of rain. That bird is much more miserable than both Brian or I. Well, Brian, of course, is in a. I wish we could show you what Brian looks like. I might have to take a picture with my phone and then you can see. Doesn't it look like a sad, sad bird? Let me just quickly unlock the phone. Now, while we look at that gorgeous Bataleer Egli. That, everybody, is what Brian looks like. Can you see Brian?
Oh, wonderful.
He looks like he's very comfortable there. That's marvellous. Good, back to the bird. I've now lost feeling in my fingers. I'm going to have to sit on my hand for a while. Ah, that's good. Aaron, you, like many of us, are waiting for two things. Firstly, the Impala lamb of the season, the first one, and then secondly, of course, the woodland kingfisher, which arrived tomorrow last year, if you know what I mean. It arrived tomorrow last year, 16th of November. And Aaron, you're wondering if this increased rain will bring them down here any faster. No, I don't think so. I think that round about now is when they would normally arrive. And so I think they probably will arrive fairly soon. Very soon we shall hear the chip, brrr. And for the first week, the chip, brrr will be a lovely sound of the summer. And then after 2 or 3 weeks, we'll think, well, that's quite loud. And then after 4 months, we'll just be so happy when they pick up their bags and go away. Sorry, that's quite emotional. It doesn't so much apply in this area, everybody, but where I used to work, up at Ngala, which was in the middle of a Mopani woodland. And Mopani has lots of fungus in the heartwood, which means that there are lots of holes for woodland kingfishers to breed in. And it meant that you were living in a swarm of woodland kingfishers through the summer, and by the time they left, everybody couldn't wait for them to go. But over here, they're just the right number, of course. I'm very glad you're all pleased that Brian is warm and comfy, unlike that Batelier and me. That poor Batelier, there's nothing he can do. Right, let's carry on. At least he has oil on his feathers, of course, and the oil on his feathers will help him to stay relatively waterproof. But you see, he's probably been sitting in the rain now for, well, I don't know, when did it start raining? Probably last night at around 10 o'clock. And it's been going pretty much ever since. And if you look frontwards to where we're going, which you don't really have a choice about doing, because if you look to the side, all you're going to see is canvas, you can see that there really is quite a lot more weather coming in at the moment. We're expecting to have 70 millimetres in the next, or before Friday. Now, 70 millimetres in inches is about 2.5 plus 2.5 plus 2.5. It's about three inches of rain in the next 4 or 5 days. So that's quite a lot. But this roof has made a vast difference to our lives. We would definitely have wrapped the drive a long time ago, everybody, if we didn't have this roof that the great Connor has managed to construct for us. Well done, Connor.
Well done, Connor.
Well done. Good job. Excellent. Well played. We did have one. We had two things to show you, but I'm afraid we lost signal. The first was a... What was it, Brian?
A tortoise.
A tortoise, yes. Speaks hinged tortoise, and then we had a hippopotamus in Biffleshook Dam, and it was just lying down in the mud. Now, I think there's a vulture just up ahead there. Ryan, do you see? And there you will see the mist. Look at the mist. Oh, it is so misty and ominous. Papow. Pow. Now that is a vulture, and the vulture has decided to hide its head from the world. It's tucked its head underneath its wing in order to stay warm. Now that's very clever if you're a vulture, because you don't have much feathering on your head, so your head, a bit like mine and Steph's, which also don't have much feathering on them, get cold when there is a wind and rain. It's quite clever. It looks a bit disembodied, doesn't it, Brian? Look at that mist, everyone. Ooh. That's where Taylor is, pretty much. Okay. Let's carry on from that little sighting. I'm rather hoping that this misty morning will bring us our first baby impala. But we've seen nothing but... We did see a steenbok as well. But Steph was busy with a microscope, so it ran away. It was very insulted that we didn't want to come to it immediately. Marvellous to have Steph in the tent, I must say. That's an interesting one, Michael, to which we don't really know the answer at this stage. You say, do the animals react differently to the vehicle with its little roof on it, with Brian's house? That's Brian just cleaning the lens. No, not yet. They didn't react at all when we drove into the lion sighting. They did a little bit when we flapped down the flaps, but that's because they went ha-wump, ha-wump. But once the ha-wumping had finished, they stopped being upset about it. Now, there's a bird above us, which I'm afraid you are going to be unable to see. Can you see it there, Brian?
I can. Look at that.
Gorgeous. It's a gymnogene, everyone, being attacked by a drongo. It was really a gymnogene being attacked by a drongo. Sorry about that. That's the one disadvantage, of course, of the roof. One day, of course, we'll have a foldable, retractable glass roof like, well, I don't know, like you've got on a sort of fancy BMW or some sort. Yes, exactly, Louise, like a convertible, but with a see-through roof. Be nice, Brian, wouldn't it, to just go beep and have it fold on and off. Putting the roof on is, look, it's not the most impossible thing in the world, but it's not very easy. One must be physically capable. And it does help to be quite tall. Now, Steph is finding all the content today. He's managed to find some sort of insect. I've no doubt it will be very colourful, especially in high-definition microscope.
It actually is. It is a jewel beetle that we found on a raisin bush that's just outside the tent. I must say, James's tent is a source of endless fascination. Once the rain has stopped and I got my jacket and I was feeling a bit warm and motivated to go outside. But come and have a look at this. It is the most unbelievably pretty beetle. Have a look at that. Tiny, no bigger than no longer than the fingernail on your hand. The baby fingernail on your hand. And just look at how fantastically colored this is. A bright coppery coppery-colored head. Excuse the shake there, everybody. It's the caffeine this morning and the lack of a stand. And you can see that it's been feeding on the sap of this leaf because of the presence of the droppings behind the beetle. It's been there for quite some time, enjoying, I don't know what it looks like. It is just so splendidly colored. So I would say that this is a jewel beetle. It's unfortunately not identifiable in the book that we have on Insects With Us. Now, Anna Marie, you've just asked, have I always had an interest in insects? And thank you very much for paying me a compliment to say that you learn so much from these insects from me. I actually have, to be quite honest with you. And I must say, it's always been, I grew up in a forested area of South Africa, a very tropical forested area of South Africa, in the tops of trees. My memory just tells me I was virtually a primate for my whole childhood. Blessed childhood, in actual fact, and we were inundated with a lot of different insects in the house. And I think my interest really started from there, in that you were either scared of them and, you know, went into a flat panic, or like me, your interest was piqued. And I took that a little bit further. When I was at university, I studied zoology for 2 years, and in my second year was privileged enough to study under a doctor or professor, Eric Holm, who was one of South Africa's leading entomologists. And for most of my second year at university, I spent with my nose in the books for insects, which of course then translated into a deep understanding of insects here. Well, love for insects, not a deep understanding. My understanding was very shallow, in actual fact, of insects. But it's nice to share it with you. All right, now before James's tortoise runs away in this cold weather, we're going to be sending you over to him, and I'm going to be looking at this jewel beetle a little bit more.
Brian, what's that?
That, James, is a tortoise.
A tortoise.
A tortoise.
That, everybody, is the Speaks Hinged tortoise. I don't know why Brian and I are saying tortoise like that, but tortoise. We started doing it earlier on, and it feels so very satisfying to say tortoise.
Look, a tortoise.
That tortoise, everybody, is really enjoying the wind. And those ones live in termite mounds and specially little designed burrows. And now he's going to hopefully eat some nice fresh vegetation. There you are, have a bite. Go on. Eat your greens. Because a tortoise like this does not only eat greens. It's drinking. Look at it, it's drinking out of the leaf. How cool is that? It also eats giant land snails, believe it or not. So he's looking for a snail, some escargot to eat. He's very streamlined, this fellow. So he's looking for a little bit of escargot for breakfast. Would you like escargot for breakfast, Brian?
No.
Not?
No.
Not your vibe?
No, not really. I don't think I've ever eaten escargot.
It's quite nice. It tastes like sort of garlic snot.
Oh, lovely.
Mm.
Wonderful.
I think that Totos is hiding from us now, Brian.
True.
See how well hidden he is. Now, the best part of where we are now, everybody, is that we're at the far southeastern corner of Juma, which means from here on, the wind and rain will be behind us, to our backs. So that is very good news. Not for Brian, of course, who's basically as comfortable as, well, somebody at home. Goodbye, Tadas! Janelle, much as you're wondering how we survive through these trying times of the rain, you're wondering what the birds and animals do when there's a heavy downpour. Well, they normally just hide in the bushes if they happen to be mammals, and the big birds just kind of hunker down and sit like that, and they can't really do anything about it. But the other birds will get into thick bush. So some of them will get into thick bush and try and avoid the rain. Others will just kind of suck it up, as it were, like that... That roller you saw for the first time this morning with Taylor, that roller probably would have just had to put up with the rain. They have to display, they like to display their territories. And I don't think they, you know, I'm sure their bodies register cold. Whether they register that sensation as unpleasant or not, I don't know. But it certainly is it's not a nice thing for us to be wet, and so this roof is great for some. Justin, you're wondering about Tata's eggs and how they manage to lay them. I'm not sure about the Speke's Hinge Tata's or where it puts its eggs, but I'm pretty sure they will be under the ground. They will definitely be under the ground. And then the sex of the new little tortoiselings will be determined by the temperature. And again, it's very specific to each reptile species as to what temperature determines which sex. But I think it's somewhere around the breaking point, somewhere around 37 degrees Celsius or so, which is about, what is that? That's about 98 degrees Fahrenheit. And around about that point, any hotter than that and the babies will be males, any colder than that and the babies will be females. But they lay their eggs under the ground somewhere. Where they dig those burrows, I don't know. I suspect quite strongly in a termite mound, and I don't know how many they lay, but if memory serves me correctly, it's about 20 eggs, I think. And that is the Speke's Hinge Tadas. There are tracks of a massive elephant bull here. Ex-Ranger, you see, you are correct, of course. You're sitting in Tasmania, if I'm not mistaken. You say you thought it was the heat that made people go mad, but you see now that it is, in fact, the rain. It is the rain, yes. Brian went mad first, I think, and then I went mad shortly thereafter. And that is why we say, Tatas!
Weather doesn't make us mad. We're
doesn't
mad
it?
Already.
Yes. Right. I'm going to give Brian his medication now, and while I do that, let's go across to Taylor and get an update from her.
We're still sitting here with young Hosana and Shongile, who are curled up into little balls, having a sleep, awaiting the arrival of their beautiful mother, Karula. However, there's been no sign of her so far, and we suspect that she's disappeared maybe into the south looking for a meal, because that's sort of where all their tracks were, but we're obviously a little bit uncertain. Now, we're just going to stay here for a couple more minutes, and then we're going to carry on and see what else we've got out in the wilderness this morning. I believe it sounds like James is having an absolute field day with all the small little critters, all the tortoises and things that he's picking up along the way. I'll be quite excited to find some of those too. And well, hopefully this afternoon, these little cubs will be reunited with their mother. And well, I'm almost hoping that she hasn't made a kill south of the boundary. I hope she comes back and then tries again here in the north, because we're a bit selfish. We'd like to see her every single day if we could. So that's what I'm hoping. It's been so nice to have all three of them around, and also just to get an update on their condition and how they're doing. And at least we can safely report and say that they look fantastic, healthy, growing well, developing their own personalities, turning into beautiful leopards. Shongile is not even showing her face or her nose. She's got it tucked underneath her tail, trying to keep herself nice and warm. Now, hello, Ellen from Arkansas. You were wondering, would these leopards' cubs have a tough time trying to climb a tree and get away from a potential predator because the rain has now made the bark nice and slippery? Now, I don't think so, because what happens is when they do climb up the trees, they bring those claws out, which they keep hidden away, so we know how nice and sharp they are, and hook it right into the bark. So unless it's perhaps an old tree and the bark is flaking, that might be a little bit tough with a combination of the rain, obviously wetting the bark, but I think that they will be all right. Let's have a look. They've got quite a few little trees around here, and you know what they've actually got? They've got this big marula. Now, sorry, the pole is in the way, but they could quite easily go up this marula tree. You see there's little crevices. It's not too high, and there's a couple of horizontal branches, and they'd easily be able to run up here and climb up to this tree, to the very top. And if not this tree, well, there's so many bush willows and other fallen marulas in the area. They'll definitely be able to get away, even if they hide in a thorn shrub, something like that. That might be another tactic that they will do. So that's where you also have to say thanks again to the elephants that push over the big trees and create the big mess. Of course, like I always like to say, the ground birds like to go and hide underneath that. A leopard cub may use that strategy to get away too. But for these two, for now, I think they're safe. The lions, I think, are quite far away from these two. And they'll just have to listen carefully. Oh, there's Hosanna shuffling again, trying to get comfy. Hello, boy. But it's not raining heavily. It's just a, I suppose you could call it a mizzle. It's a miserable drizzle. So it's a... Yes, I've had guests actually tell me that once, a mizzle. So I said it the other day in camp, and everyone looked at me as if I was going bonkers, but that is a word, I think. And I think it describes the rain perfectly. Shame, I feel so sorry for him. He's just looking into the distance, hoping that he's going to see Mom coming around the corner. And what's caught his attention is, I don't know if you can hear it, it's very far away, but there's a couple of birds shouting. But that could also just be a food party moving through, because it sounds like a couple of different species. Rollers, and so I heard a chagra and a drongo. So perhaps it's just a food party moving through. Sorry, my boy. Not the birds shouting at your mother. And back to sleep he goes. I think we're going to leave these two little bundles of joy sleep away in this miserable weather. And if we get any reports that Karula has come back, well, then I'll definitely try and sneak back into the sighting. But for now, I think we will let them rest and have a good sleep. Now this is going to be fun because we've got the roof. And it's a quite wooded area, lots of terminalias, lots of bush willows around. We need to try and find a way to get out. So let's see how this is going to go. But luckily, not too many thorn trees, which is good. The thorn trees are the ones you really want to avoid with the roof, because they can rip the top, and we don't want to do that. But now I also can't see. Let's turn here. I Okay, so what I'm going to do, I think this is going to be a little bit trickier than what I thought, and you're probably going to laugh at me getting stuck. So let's go back across to James so I can save myself the embarrassment.
All right. Now, the other day when I was on a walk, we managed to find these little grasshoppers that I want to show you here. This is a full-grown grasshopper. I'm being very careful not to hurt him for you. But they live in short grass areas on rocky ground. And we were amazed at exactly how camouflaged these grasshoppers are. There it is there from the side. Have a look there. Now, at the time, I called it a stone locust because they resemble stones and grass. So just have a look at that. But what I really want to do is show you what they look like in their environment. So I've mocked up an environment here. Have a look at that. I'm going to see if I can get him closer with this microscope for you. Just so that you can see the stones. No. Have a look there while I'm busy doing it with David in the camera. That's probably a better view. Have a look at that camouflage, what a few stones can do. Isn't that the most awesome thing you've ever seen? All right, now we're going to let him go. I don't want to hurt him too much. And then I'll show you what type of locust he is, mainly because it doesn't really have a common name, I'm finding out. Excuse me blasting you like that. I just want to put him on the sand where we found him. He can carry on with his day. All right. This is the grasshopper that we were looking at. Right there. You can see those short, stubby little legs, very powerful. They don't fly. They live on, they feed on short grass and they live in sandy areas. And they look like the stones that they live amongst, mainly to stay hidden. Now, you're going to help me with this name because I cannot pronounce it. Have a look at that. Tmetonata is how I would say it. Tmetonata. And as you can see, occurring over the whole of South Africa. So I'd call it a stone locust. Of course, there are other stone locusts that are actually stone locusts. They don't occur here. They occur in the... There we go. There's a stone grasshopper. That is what I thought that it was, a stone grasshopper. You can see there, looking very much like the stones that it's around. I mean, you can forgive my oversight to that one. This Tmetonata that we have over here. Definitely him. These ones here. These little guys there. That's what we were just having a look at. Tmetonata, and fairly common that we're finding them out here, all on the open grass areas. Awesome. So you see, you learn something new here every single day, and just give you a little bit of time to actually sit down and research some of the things that we're seeing out here. You can establish some of the most amazing facts. Obviously quite humbling, and also the fact that somebody has managed to know so much that they've written a book about it, and now we have access to it. Makes me feel a bit lazy and useless from time to time. I must say, it's been, for a wet day, it's been a pretty awesome game drive experience. I mean, we've got the lions on the property, and we've also got those two young leopard that you've been sharing time with Taylor. Of course, we can expect the seasons to change now with the rain coming along and the animals to disperse into the bush around us. We've got an enormous expanse of bush up and around the 8 million acres. And that is going to allow a lot of dispersal. All right. Now, Rachel, sorry, you've just asked me a question. I couldn't quite catch it through there. This is a bushwalk earpiece that I've got at the moment. I just want to get that question. All right. So, Rachel, you just asked which is my favorite season to guide in the bush. Rachel, I quite enjoy May, because it's the end of the beginning of the dry season, end of the wet season, the grass is starting to lie nice and flat, and animals are starting to come to watering points. And so you're getting these concentrations of animals starting to happen. And then I also enjoy January. Out of the two, May or January, I enjoy January the most. And it's mainly because of just the sheer number and diversity of life that we find out here. And it actually ties in quite nicely with my previous statement about what can we expect to evolve during these safaris for the next couple of months. We can absolutely expect the amount of species that we see in any one game drive to increase. So the amount of birds, the amount of insects, frogs that we're starting to uncover, and just generally just the diversity of life we can expect to increase, but we can expect the numbers of animals that we see to decrease. Not the diversity, there will always be lion and leopard and buffalo and elephant and wildebeest and such around, but their numbers will start to decrease. So as we start going into our summertime, we can expect the fact that we won't see 100 elephant on a game drive, we will see 20 or 30. We won't see lions every single day, we'll see lions every now and again. As the animals disperse, so the lion and so the leopard will have to disperse and hunt a lot more vigorously through their territories in order to find enough food to feed one another. Things that are territorial don't disperse as wide. So let's use lion again as an example. Lion will just, they have an area that they live in, territory, a core territory that they'll defend with their lives in some cases, and a home range, which is the area that they will move in. They don't go out of that area. In this particular area, lions have home ranges of about 5,000 hectares, which is about 10,000 acres or so. And they will, in summertime, they will be moving through these areas a lot, mainly because the prey availability is scattered. Animals don't have to come to a particular water point to get water, and so they don't have to congregate. And also food is available all over the place. And so you get these little groups of animals spread out all over the Kruger National Park, making it difficult for predators, making it easier for the herbivores. But also, it's going to make it a bit, it'll be different. For those of you who've been following Safari Life for all these years, you'll notice that species will absolutely increase and numbers will actually decrease. And so that's what we can expect over the next couple of months. Looking forward to it, though, to be quite honest with you. All right. We are going to be sending you over to one of the others at the moment. Oh, excuse me. We're not going to go over there. We're going to answer a question. Now, Clinton, you've just asked me how long does a wet season normally last. Clinton, we have our rains, our first rains falling in about September. First rains over 20 millimeters. So first rains over this much. We're having falling in September to October sometime. And then the rains sort of go away and we're finding these sporadic frontal rains like we're having today, occurring all the way up until December when the low pressure system is situated firmly close to the country, over the two low pressures that govern our rainfall are situated over the country. And then we start getting our heavy rains from about Christmas until about March, with the heaviest rains falling at the end of January to mid-February sometime. That is when we have our wettest season. The last, it rains almost every single month here, but the last decent rains that we have, we can expect at the beginning of April, sometimes into May, but very rarely into May, and then it'll start tapering off, with the driest month being October, where we have virtually, we have maybe a rainfall or two, but virtually no rain in October. Yes, and that's about that from a seasonal point of view, from rainfall. Temperature-wise, the hottest temperatures are also in October, for me at least anyway. I think the hottest months are January through to February, where it'll peak very, very on very hot days into the upper 50 degrees centigrade over here. But quite often is quite short-lived, and there'll be these billowing clouds that develop, these cumulo clouds that then blot out that burning sun, and obviously sometimes bring thunder showers in the afternoon, which cools things down considerably. Night times here, comfortable most nights, probably about 3 to 6 weeks a year where it becomes unbearably hot here. And so it does get uncomfortably hot here for a about 3 to 6 weeks, depending on the year. And then cold, I don't know, I get cold very, very easy. I'm a person who enjoys the heat, but it does get cold here. Freezing, just below freezing, just over freezing, also for about 3 to 6 weeks a year. So it doesn't, we don't get snow here, but it definitely gets cold enough to warrant lots of balaclavas. I don't know, I have 3 or 4 blankets on my bed. I sleep uncomfortably for 3 or 4 weeks over here. And the rest of the year is pretty much temperate and quite pleasant to live in, to be quite honest. And it's one of the more pleasant places on Earth, I'm told, to live. Anyway, on that note, James has found some signal again, and so we're going to be putting you onto his vehicle and hearing what he has to say.
We also found some impala, everybody, but none of them had a little baby. Female that was with them, the ewe, was very, very full of babies still, so they haven't given birth yet as far as we can tell. And I'm sure that in fact, I think I mentioned it the other day, there are a few down in the south of the reserve, impala lambs I mean, but very few up here. And that's interesting, because people will tell you, of course, that impala are able to drop their lambs when conditions are favorable. Well, conditions have been favorable up in the north here for a lot longer than they have down in the south. And interestingly, well, not surprisingly to my mind anyway, the impalas have given birth with much the same control that we have over when we give birth, which of course is no control whatsoever. Well, if you're going for natural childbirth, that is. James, you're wondering about the... you're wondering about this, these sorts of conditions and whether they will be a bad time for impala to give birth, probably because you think maybe these conditions are better for predators than they would be otherwise. James, yes, to a certain extent that is true. I suppose it wouldn't be ideal for them, but for two reasons. I think far more dangerous than the weather conditions. It just means the predators are going to hunt during the day more than they would, as opposed to at night only. I think far more dangerous would be the fact that the youngsters could die of cold shock quite quickly in weather like this. You'll see here, Brian. Do you know what this is, Brian?
It is a flower.
It is a flower? Do you know what kind of flower it is? Have a guess. It begins with a J. And ends with a ein. And it has an S in the middle.
G.
Ja. There we go. Well done, Brian. Some wild jasmine, everybody. And I know you shouldn't really pick wild flowers, but they smell so delicious. Couldn't stop myself. It smells just like jasmine you might have in your garden, probably slightly more subtle and with a little bit more honey. Oh, it is wonderful. Have a smell, everybody.
Thank you. Oh, that's delicious.
It is so delicious. Brian is now very happy, everybody.
Thank you,
Dan. So delicious. And you can also see that the conditions are brightening up slightly. That doesn't mean that the rain has stopped, but it is certainly getting a bit brighter, which is nice. I shall still put my rain cover back on my leggies, because I, unlike Brian, am not in a tent. Or Steph, of course. Right, on we go. It's delicious. Mm. Put it there. Oh, Verena, I feel like I really should know the answer to this question. There is a Nyala cow. She's on her own. Rena, sorry. Rena, you want to know about malaria and whether animals can get it? My answer is no, they can't. And I think the reason for that is that just over evolutionary time, they have developed an immunity to it. So animals do not get malaria as far as I know. And as far as I know, the I think they're trypanosomes, they're called, which are the parasites. As far as I know, the malaria parasite needs a human host. It cannot survive in animals. We are animals, in wild animals other than humans, as far as I know. Oh, it's very, very wet, Nyala, that. Where the rest of her herd is, I don't know. They're probably in the thicker bush there just behind. Justin, you want to know this flower is edible. I'll taste a petal for you.
Delicious. Not so much. Oh dear.
Justin, I don't know if it's edible. It doesn't taste very nice. I really don't know about this plant, so I'd be very careful about eating it. I just gave it a very brief taste. And if you are out here and you're wondering and you find yourself desperate for something to eat, and, maybe there's been a great flood and you've been unable to get out of your lodge and you're alone, there is a kind of rule of thumb. If you want to test if something is toxic out here, you do exactly what I just did there. You take a very slight bite with your, or put it on the top of your teeth, and you taste that. If there's any kind of burning sensation, then you immediately discard it. If there isn't too much of a burning sensation, you can probably put it on your tongue and see if there's any burning sensation then, and if there isn't, then you can probably go a little bit further and maybe swallow a very tiny little piece, see if that has any effect, and that's basically how you work out whether something is poisonous or not. I'm not going to go through that process as far as the wild jasmine goes. I'll probably just go and read up on it when I get home. But it smells too delicious to be poisonous. Right, the Nyala has disappeared into the bush. Let's continue. We've seen just one very small herd of impala today. I think hiding. A bit like Brian in his tent. There's a whole lot of bird activity going on here. They're just on the tree there, Brian, on that knob thorn. I think there's a crombeck. Honey's ocelot, oh, well spotted. As we look for that bird that's hopping about in there, you want to know what that plant that smells like diesel is. It is a little crombeck, long-billed crombeck. It's called Clerodendrum tapetum. Clerodendrum tapetum. Clerodendrum tonatum. Judy H. is going to be very upset with me. Clerodendrum tonatum is what it's called, and I don't think it has a common name. Beautiful white flowers, foul-smelling diesel leaves. There it is, little crombeck, no tail at all. Isn't that sweet? It's not what's calling. You can hear a drongo calling in the background, everyone. That little bird goes... Gorgeous. And then on the road, sorry, Brian, is a ring-necked dove, fluffed out for the cold, trying to find some grass seeds to eat. This, of course, the bird of peace, and the preening that it's doing now is extremely important because that's how it stays free of water. And you can see it's doing a rather better job than that Batalea was. Spreading oil from the glands. I think, where are those preening glands? They're just underneath the chest there, I think. And it'll be taking oil from those chest glands onto the feathers and just covering them in oil so that it stays waterproof in the rain. Looking for little grass seeds and probably ants. I think rather like the impala, you know, with the ring-necked dove. There is a kind of temptation to pass them off as common and not too worthy of too much consideration. But they're truly impressive birds when you think about what they achieve. Very, very fast. They're common because they're highly successful out here. And they walk quite nicely, don't you think, Brian?
No.
Yeah. Right, well, this dove is going to go across the road, out of view fairly soon. Let's head across to Taylor, get an update from her, and we'll head north continuously.
Now, earlier we were talking about... I'm actually first going to jump out the vehicle very quickly. But we were talking about things that could potentially harm a leopard's cubs. Now, I've got the footprints of one of those exact things. Let's show you. They look like massive footprints. Feet prints is not a word. Hey, Jean-André, I was saying that earlier. Now it's stuck in my head. Feet prints does not exist. I'm going to go to these ones over here because these ones look a little bit nicer. Let's have a look at this big track over here. Just make sure that there's nothing. But of course, it's quite easy to tell that it's a hyena track. Where's my stick? Let's get a little stick. Because, and I think we showed you leopard tracks a couple of mornings ago. The most important thing is that when you look at the back pad. Now, unfortunately, this track over here doesn't seem to be the neatest of tracks. But you can clearly see. I don't know. I hope you can clearly see. Chandra's shaking his head. Anyway, there are two lobes. One, two, and they always seem to stand at a bit of an angle as well when they run. They're not very neat. It's not like a horse that flicks its toes out and it's got a beautiful, perfect track. I think when a hyena runs, should I demonstrate? Let me demonstrate how a hyena runs. I'm not going to go down on all fours though, because I don't think I'm... I know, because I can't, but watch my feet though. I think they run a bit like this. Something ridiculous along those lines. Yes, the silly hyenas, because their paw prints always seem to be turned in or turned out slightly, so I don't know. They've got bizarre looking feet with the big claws that I'm sure you could see, and they ran down here. It looks like, let me just double check again, after the rain there doesn't seem to be too many raindrops. And if it, let me zip back around, and I'm not convinced that they actually are hyena anymore. I'm wondering if it perhaps wasn't James or Steph early this morning out on a run. Maybe they've got new shoes with a tread with a hyena paw print. Looks like it, because there's two sets. So it could have been the two of them just playing tricks on us this morning. We haven't seen those hyenas around. Just a couple, where did I see them? On Arethusa. There were some about a couple of weeks ago. That was quite nice to see them. But now, I'm not sure what else we're going to see this morning. Jandre and I have both been talking about elephants, so I think let's see if we can find us an elephant. Don't know if there's going to be any around, but we'll have a look. Jandre, how funny is this? Look at this marula tree. I'm going to try and position it. You can actually see it. Can you see which way the wind was blowing? How cool is that? It looks as though somebody has painted the right-hand side of the tree, but of course no one has done that. It's just the rain, and obviously the wind was coming from sort of the southeast and then blowing into this tree. So just the one half of it is a little bit wet. So if it was a giraffe or maybe something that's tall and slender, an ostrich probably could have stood behind there and stayed nice and dry. I thought that was very funny, just looking at all these various trees as we go along. And well, only one side of them is a little bit wet. So let's continue. Let's see who else we can find. Maybe a millipede. That would be nice to have a look at, see if we can find a millipede, a nice long one. We'll look around some termite mounds and on the trees. I think they'll be up on the trees as well. But otherwise, an elephant would be fantastic. Now, I'm going to go searching for either one of those two creatures. I'm just quickly checking because I know they like to sit on these bush willows, those shongololos. Are they here? Not this morning. Okay, well, let's go back across to Steph, who's nice and warm and snug in his tent.
I wouldn't call it warm. The wind is howling through here, but definitely not at the same pace that it's howling through those vehicles. So I am a little bit warmer, but it's definitely chilly today. Chilly enough, at least, to warrant two jackets, a shirt, and a vest for me. Now, I'm going to ask Louise to repeat the name of that little jewel beetle that we had a little bit earlier. We have had confirmation that it is a jewel beetle. So I'm just going to ask Louise to repeat the name so that I can do it in stages. It's going to come to you. stages. Now, Georgian in Illinois, I just want to say thank you very, very much for this. Here we go. Buprestidae, which means jewel beetle. So it's a buprestid, which is good. Buprestidae acmacdera was the jewel beetle that you... Acmacdera grata. Buprestidae acmacdera grata. So thank you very, very much. It's a mouthful, that one. But thank you once again for helping us identify that one, at least. It's not in the books that I have, but at least we've got you out there helping us with that. So thank you very much. Now, on to the next thing. Now, the other day on the walk, we found a male bushveld rain frog. Now, the rain frogs are some of the cutest things that you have out here, and I want to see if I can show this one to you. I've kept it in a little container. A is because we don't pick up frogs out here with your hands. The acids that we have on our hands can harm them. So with frogs in the decline worldwide, it's a good thing not to pick up frogs with your hands. But come and have a look at this little guy. This is full grown. That's the male. Let me see if I can just get him in so that you can see him. Have a look at how cute he is. Little alien-like dude. Just look at that. Now, the females are many times his size. Let's see if we can get his face. That's probably the most redeeming feature, is those faces that they have. And that bulldog-like stance. Now, apart from being quite noisy little frogs out here, they're also quite common, one of the more common of the frogs out here. The male is much smaller than the female. And the interesting thing about these particular frogs is that during amplexus, which is the mating of frogs, they have adhesion that also takes place. The male climbs onto the back of the female. He then secretes a chemical which causes her to secrete a glue, and she sticks him to her. So he gets stuck to her back, and I found a picture of it right there. And she then walks around with him stuck to her back. And you can actually see there, you can't actually separate them without actually killing him. You'll pull his skin off. You can see how much bigger the female is than him. Isn't that amazing? That's these little guys. I quite enjoy them anyway. We're going to put him back in the bush. I'm going to send you off to Taylor.
We have found an elephant. We have found an elephant. There actually are three. Thanks, Jandre, for getting that tune. It stuck in my head, and I just thought that I'd sing it for all of you. But we finally found one of the creatures that we were looking for this morning. So the list is getting shorter. And, well, we've stumbled across three elephant bulls who look very wet and seem to be quite hungry as well, as they reach up to the tops of the trees to feed on only the most succulent leaves. That rhymed as well. That was very unintentional. I'm feeling a bit like Dr. Seuss this morning, but not quite as... he's got better poems than I do, of course. But I'm so happy. We haven't been really seeing the elephants around. And even though it's not a family with tiny little babies, at least we get to see some beautiful boys who in a couple of years are going to be massive. Oh, Chandra, look what's going on over here. It's a bit difficult. I think, should I go forward for you? Let me go forward. This elephant is stretching right up to the top of this tree. Oh, no. There we go. There's a gap. Sorry, it's a small gap, but there is one. And was reaching right to the top, so I wonder if it's going to do it again. It was standing on three legs. It was quite entertaining to see. Now, eating a marula tree, which seems to be the favorite food of the elephants at the moment, and for once not seeing them pushing the trees down, which is quite nice. I'm sure that the trees are quite happy about that, as it must be terrible to be uprooted from the ground and then to lay on your side for the rest of your life. And it also looks like they may have had a dust bath. I don't think now, though, but if you look at this elephant, you can see a couple of patches of a rust color. So I suspect that maybe yesterday, before the rains, or they would have had a nice dust bath. They're all covered in this sort of orangey sand. I wonder where they've been. I haven't really seen too much red soil in the area, so perhaps they've maybe come from the north. Maybe Biffle's Hook has got some areas where there's a bit of iron in the soil, which often causes the redness, and that, of course, is the oxidation process. When iron comes into contact with oxygen, it turns red, and that's also what happens with the rust. But let's hope these elephants don't rust with all the moisture around them. Now, looking at these boys' tusks, and I mentioned to you that they're relatively young still. They're not particularly old. And Justin, you were wondering by itself how much would a piece of ivory weigh. Now, Justin, it depends. These boys don't have too big of a tusk. Oh, I'll get your question now. He's now having a scratch. Did you see that? Just having a rub up on the marula tree. So what you're looking at, when you look at their tusks, we can't see the entire tusk. There's still a bit that goes into the flesh. So it's probably another ruler length, I would say. Oh, there he is, stretching up again to the top of the tree. Come on, do a jump for us, or can you reach that? I promise, Justin, I'll get back to your question. See what he's doing? He's trying to break some of the branches down from this marula so that he can then feed on the leaves. But he looks like he's struggling. And it's very typical to see elephants doing this. We saw it a lot in Zambia, and you see it in mana pools too. In the dry seasons, the only tree that has got leaves on it is the winter thorn acacias. And they are massive trees, sort of as big as knobthorns grow. Wow! And they will stand on their hind legs to reach the tops of the trees. But this elephant has still got it easy. There's still plenty of foliage on the lower branches. He just has to snap a couple of bits off every now and then, and he'll be quite happy. Maybe even these other mates that are around here will come over and feast on the marula leaves that he's pulled down. But Justin, let me get back to your question, because otherwise I'm going to get sidetracked again. So it depends on the tusk. Both tusks are not identical, so some may grow longer, some may get thicker. And, well, that would depend. These tusks, oh, it's hard to say. I wouldn't say more than about, let's take a guess, about 50 pounds. Somewhere along there. They're not potentially huge, but a big elephant bull's tusks, oh my goodness. When I was in Zambia, and it was very sad, and I think I told the story the other day of this elephant that had got poached, and we managed to capture the poachers, though. And we obviously took back the ivory, and they were massive tusks. They must have stood at about a meter and a half in sort of height. I'm so terrible. My conversions in feet are horrendous, but I shall practice again this afternoon. But they weighed quite a bit. They weighed just over 100 pounds. This boy, his tusks seem to be a little bit thicker than the other elephants that we were looking at, so the thickness will definitely make them weigh a little bit more. Not quite as long as the others, so maybe slightly more heavier than the others, so maybe 55, 60 pounds. And if you remember me telling you about the Magnificent Seven elephants, the sort of the elephants that roamed the Greater Kruger area that the scientists suspected to have the woolly mammoth gene in them, they were particularly large, you know, weighing well in excess of 6 or 7 tons, and they had tusks that touched the ground and grew straight down rather than having that curve towards the sky that we see with these elephants. And their tusks were enormous. If I'm not mistaken, their one weighed about almost 150 pounds. But then, of course, the other tusk was slightly smaller. So they're massive. It's not light stuff. It's heavy. But let's see. This bull is coming over to us now. And I don't think they're going to be particularly bothered by the roofs. I think that these elephants, they move over. We see it with Daryl, the elephant with a bell in his ear. He goes right to the Sabi River and then comes back to the north and heads into the Manuleti as well. So I'm sure that these boys have seen roofs. They've heard the different rumbles that the different makes of vehicles give out, so they won't be too bothered by us at all. I think Jamie said it, the only ones that might be quite interested will be the little and Kahuma cubs, because they probably have never seen roofs before until us. But even that, it'll be a quick adjustment and they'll be relaxed again. And he's been so careful and gentle as he's picking specific little plants that he wants to eat. He must have a craving for something. What that is, I'm unsure. But I'm very happy that we managed to find the elephants. Now, all we've got to do is find a shongololo, a millipede, before the end of drive. So I'm going to go searching for one of those creatures with lots of legs. But let's go back to Steph and see what he's got for you in the tent.
Today seems the day for the jewel beetles that are not described in any of the common books that we have around here. We had that previous buprestid, the jewel beetle with those stripes and the yellow on, and at the bottom of a flaky thorn acacia, I have just found that little guy. You can see him over there, no larger than my fingernail. But come and have a look at the colors on this one. Look at that. Isn't that just gorgeous? This deep purple color on the back of the wings. Decided that it doesn't want to play ball. And then on the belly, it has a bronze, metallic bronze color. And I'm gonna see if I can show you the belly here. That is the bottom of this particular Schaefer, is this deep, deep bronze color. Don't worry, I'll flick you over now, back onto your face. And look at the gold eye. Wow. That is the eye of the, that is amazing. And even down to the antennae are metallic. Now obviously, jewel beetles are designed to catch the sun and to look spectacular in the sun. Okay, I'm gonna turn this one over just so we limit some panic. But that absolutely fantastic shape on the, have a look there. Gorgeous. My find of the day. Sitting underneath the leaf, so, oh, man. And you got that sheen going on there. These beetles are collected all over the world in insect collections and are highly traded. Some of them actually trading for many thousands of dollars and euros each. This one I'm going to hide away so that no one else can find him. Only I'll know where to find them in future. Anyway, it's come to that time of the day when I need to say goodbye. And I just want to say thank you. What an amazing experience this morning was for me. Thank you very, very much for your help, in particular with IDing all the insects that I didn't know. And I just want to say thank you for your questions and your support again. So, without further ado, I'm going to say enjoy your day or your night, wherever you are in the world, and we'll catch up with you again for the afternoon PM safari.
Now, we're just having one last look around here, everybody. We're on quarantine hoping we might see, hoping we might see an impala. There was a green wood hoopoe there that flied away, Brian. But we have not seen hide nor hair of another impala since we lost signal on Twin Dams Road. So we'll just have one quick look around here and see if we aren't very lucky indeed. As they do quite like to be down in this little clearing area sometimes, especially if they're a bit hungry and it's a bit blustery. But I suspect they've gone into the thick stuff, like everything else. You will notice I'm wearing my jasmine.
Splendid.
It is very splendid. I can now smell it all the time. Ah. splendidly pretty. Paul, on a subject completely unrelated to the jasmine on the side of my head, you want to know if we tend to drink coffee or tea in South Africa? We drink both. In our camp, we drink quite a lot of coffee.
Way too much coffee.
Brian thinks we drink way too much coffee. I think we drink just about the right amount. Some people drink tea. Rebecca's a big tea drinker. Certainly, my father and mother have tea twice a day. They have it in the morning and in the afternoon, and when I'm with them, I share in that tradition. And, of course, it's very much a sort of throwback, I suppose. The days of the empire, Brian.
Oh, yes.
And you had to have tea and gin tonics at the right time of the day from the correct sort of crockery and cutlery. But yes, we drink both out here, Paul. I enjoy both, especially with naughty cakes and things. Delicious.
What's your favourite? Rusks?
No, I don't like rusks, Brian. You know I don't like rusks. All right, we're just outside home, everybody, so we're going to turn into home. Thank you for coming on our rainy safari today, and thank you especially for the wonderful conversation we had around animal emotions, and hopefully that little lion cub will no longer be suffering anymore. We will see you this afternoon for the sunset safari. I think we're doing an open rehearsal, as far as I'm aware, so for 2 hours from 4 o'clock until 6 o'clock. We can hand you over to Taylor for the last few minutes of the drive. Bye-bye.
We've got two unlikely friends sitting up here on the tree. You can see a white-backed vulture, and then it looks like a tawny eagle on the right-hand side, who's very fluffed up and probably a little bit on the cold side this morning. Now, I thought this was so beautiful as we just came around the corner and saw these two perched up. And I don't think I've ever seen another species of bird other than perhaps a drongo or the odd starling sitting with a vulture, mobbing it. But to see these two quite casually and quite happily sitting right next to each other is very interesting. And just a moment ago, they had a little bit of an argument and they sort of pecked each other, but now they've settled down and are back to being friends again. But I thought that this was quite wonderful. And they're probably just going to sit here. The rain has now stopped, touch wood, as I touch my head. There's not a mizzle anymore. So it will give the birds an opportunity with this breeze to start grooming themselves, preening themselves, opening up their wings, letting their feathers dry out nicely. And I suspect that that's what's going to happen in the next couple of hours. Let's hope that the rain does stop for just a little bit. But isn't that incredible? But let's carry on. Remember, we've got one last thing that we want to find. We have got a shongololo that we need to find. Let's see if we can quickly pick one up. I wonder if we'll be able to. Oh my God. Louise is... about that. We went into a tiny little depression and apparently there were loads and loads of gremlins, so I had to fight them off with sticks and do all sorts of crazy movements like that with my hands. Jandre was also karate chopping, getting them away. So I apologize for that, but we're back now and we've got 1 minute to find a shongololo. Will we do it, Jandre? Do you think we'll be able to find one? We've got to scan carefully on the trees though, because they seem to enjoy the trees at the moment, feeding on the leaves. Come on, shongololo, don't let us down. Okay, it seems as though we're not going to find a shongololo, but I've got some inyalas. Hello, inyalas. Can you see those in here? I'm trying to work out how to not get this pole in the way. Oh, there we go. And you can see them. I apologize, Inyala, for disturbing you from your little slumber, but I hope you keep nice and warm. Now we're coming into the final seconds of the show. I failed you by not finding the Shongololo, but perhaps this afternoon there'll be a couple of critters crawling around. Thank you to everybody, Steph, James, all the ladies in Final Control. We hope you have a wonderful dry morning, and we'll see you later today. From myself and Jandre, bye-bye.